हेलो हेलो पागल सर
सर गुड मॉर्निंग सर
गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू। अजीत अच्छा था नहीं तो रेडी था। हेलो
हाँ सर
बिल सब रेडी अरे सुबुनी कौन तुम करते का बैगल नहीं की।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग हाँ पूरा रेडी
सर। नमस्ते। हाँ सर ऑल सेट।
अजीत अजीत टोन कौन टी फ्लक्चुएट हो अजीत।
हेलो हेलो
हाँ तो टी नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लम रहो जी।
नहीं नहीं नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लम नहीं एटी टी के सपोर्ट से बड़ा हो जी। तो अबे सुबह लाता
हाँ घर सर। हाँ सुबह सुबह वो वॉइस क्लियर अजीत।
हाँ हाँ क्लियर अच्छा क्लियर अच्छा।
अरे कल रात बारटा बेलू गोटे मेसेज आसला गोटे मेल टे आसला देखीच एगारटा बारटा बेलू
सर वन ऑफ द स्पीकर हैज ऑलरेडी जॉइंड डॉक्टर
चिन्मय जॉइंड। अच्छा 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 सर गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग एम आई ऑडिबल।
यस सर यू आर ऑडिबल वेरी मच। गुड मॉर्निंग
गुड मॉर्निंग
गुड मॉर्निंग
पंडा सर योर दूसरा फ्रेंड
करो दा।
यस यस पंडा कैन आई जस्ट शेयर माय स्क्रीन फॉर 1 मिनट एंड जस्ट सी टेस्ट इट।
यस सर श्योर।
करो दा योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग।
No, no, audible. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Yes, audible, sir.
Hey, Karo.
Request.
Karo da. Chupi. Audible. Is it audible, Karo da?
Yeah, I'm audible.
Right. Fine. Right now. You're looking great today.
Thank you. I'm not able to share my screen. I don't know why.
Sir, go to present now.
Yeah.
Then you can open. Ajit sir, Bagal sir. Bagal sir. Ajit.
Sir.
Please guide Kora sir to present his content.
Sir, you just go to that present now.
Okay, no, it's okay.
Not
sure.
Yeah.
Yes, it is now.
Okay. Thank you.
Now your screen is visible to all.
Okay.
All the participants are requested to mute their audio and video.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning. गुड मॉर्निंग गुड मॉर्निंग नमस्कार नमस्कार
नमस्कार डोलबे
नमस्कार 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 नमस्कार
आफ्टर लॉन्ग टाइम।
थैंक यू सिंस आफ्टर लॉन्ग टाइम एक्चुअली। एबे कोडी माने बैक इंडिया आसलेडी ना
नहीं इंडिया रे बे अछि तापर अबू धाबी रो वीसा पे अपेक्षा कर छी।
अच्छा 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 बहुत दिन पर देखा आला है माने सिंस आफ्टर अ लॉन्ग टाइम माने आईएसएम पर आउ देखा है नी
ना थरे अपन आस्तले जीआईटी गुणपुर थरे
माने हां ये गुणपुर थरे देखा है तला
गोटे रति पे आस्तले
जाओ नहीं हमरो एलपी पंडा सर कहंती सब बळे
नहीं अपन से भी कम
एक हॉस्टल रे थिलु गुड मॉर्निंग नमस्कार
ସାର୍ ମୋ ଆଗରୁ ତ ଆପଣ ଜାଣିଛନ୍ତି ଆଇସମ ଧନବାଦରେ
ଏକ ହଷ୍ଟେଲରେ ରହୁଥିଲୁ ଯେ
ତାପରେ
ସାର୍ ସିଆଡେ ଖଡଗପୁରରେ ପିଏଚଡି କଲେ ମୁଁ ସେ ଆଇଏସ୍ଏମ୍ ରେ କଣ୍ଟିନ୍ୟୁ କରିଦେଇଥିଲି ଆଉ
ପରାଗ ଭାର୍ଗବ ସାର୍ ଆସିଲେଣି
କୋଉ ନାଁରେ
ପରାଗ ଭାର୍ଗବ ସାର୍ ଜଏନ୍ କଲେ
ନାଇଁ କରିନାହାନ୍ତି ତ
ଅଜିତ ବେଟର
ସାର୍ ବିସି ସାର୍ ୱିଲ୍ ଜଏନ୍ ଇନ୍ 1 ମିନିଟ୍ ସାର୍
ଓକେ Then we'll start immediately.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Dilip sir, good morning.
Good morning. Sir, can you start, sir? Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll start. No problem.
Okay, sir. Good morning to all. Hope you are safe and doing well. Honorable Vice Chancellor, D.K. to Odisha, Professor Dr. P.R. Tripathi, sir. Honorable Principal, Professor Dr.
D.K. Sir, D.K. Visi John Kurchundi. Sir, Visi John Kurchundi, D.K. Good to second, sir.
Achha, ticket, ticket.
One second, sir, Visi John Kurchundi.
Bagal, sir,
one second.
Okay, 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 we'll be waiting. Please, Dilip, sir, please.
Dear participant, kindly mute your audio and video.
Good morning, Principal Professor Dulu Patnaik.
Good morning, sir. I have seen some for a long time.
Yeah, that's the pandemic has given the opportunity.
Happy in the morning, I got your WhatsApp message actually. Really happy. Really happy to see you after a long time.
At least due to the corona, at least. I'll see you today, duty at least.
thank you.
Really, with a short span of time, your professor Dilip has taken a very good initiative and very good hard work. Fantastic.
Thank you, sir.
Very good. Regularly, they are touching all the participants. They're fantastic.
Our young team in all the branches are dynamic, actually.
Obviously, this energy. Obviously, very good.
They are doing actually.
Exactly.
In this scenario also, they are doing
fantastic.
Class and virtual classes like that.
Sir, this is
the Biput is creating a very good image with this. If you conduct such type of seminars and conference, the Biput obviously will get a very good image and these things be okay. We are at least connecting with the far the resources, the nice resources, the different areas.
Definitely. BPUD is taking a good step, good initiative in this regard.
Very good. It should be.
Okay. Sir has joined actually. We will start the program.
Sir, namaskar.
Good morning, everybody.
Sir, namaskar.
Good morning, Bhargav sir.
Sir, namaskar. Yeah.
Namaskar. So I welcome all the dignitaries who have joined this one-day online national webinar on innovations in product design and sustainable manufacturing. This is a good innovative step taken by the principal this is Kevunja Kolahandi. So though I am not very much conversant with this subject, but I feel that this particular national webinar will be very much helpful. They have invited experts like Professor Bhargav from IIT Bombay, Dr. Kaur from UAE, so and so many other dignitaries have already joined. So I expect this seminar to be a great success. With this, I conclude, and all the outcomes, whatever suggestions, will be given by the experts and the delegates will be recorded by the seminar secretary, and it will be helpful to all of us and to the academic world and the persons who are working in the production area in the country. Thank you, sir.
We are really happy to have you with us today. Actually, it is our we are really fortunate and being proud that today you have joined with our webinar. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you, sir.
I wish you success. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, everybody. On behalf of GCEK, I welcome you all. I welcome all the participants from the joint different corners from India. And really, I am astonished and overwhelmed to see a large number of participants in this webinar, around 560. I was really, really astonished. And in between, I found my old friends like Dr. Sushant Tripathi, Dr. Dr. Panda and others. And I also welcome our experts, Dr. Bhargav and Chinmaykar. And really, I am associated with Chinmaykar since a long time ago, actually, after so many years I am founding. I am definitely in good health and sound condition. And actually, after this meeting also, we'll be talking to him around our old ISM days.
Sure.
Thank you. And at the outset, I thank the Department of Mechanical Engineering, headed by Dr. Mrutunjay Rao. One of my friend was nearby, so I Mrutunjay Rao and his team for nicely conducting this seminar. And thanks to Dilip Bagal and Ajit Patnaik for convening this webinar. And also I am thankful to all my faculty members, those who have helped to bring this seminar to a grand success. And today I am really, really happy that within a short span of time, our VC joined our seminar and encouraged us a lot. Hope enroll in our coming seminars and workshops, he will be with us. Really, I am thankful both the experts and I am also thankful to my student coordinators for bringing this webinar to a grand success. And I advise all the participants to extract maximum from the experts so that they will acquire much more knowledge on this product design, innovations and product design. And industry expert Chinmay Kara is also there. So industry ideas and everything he can explain better and extract maximum from both the experts. And it will be beneficial for the students, participants, and all. Hope this seminar a grand success. Wish you all the best. And before that product design, innovations in product design and sustainable manufacturing, now it is a need of the hour, actually. Innovations plays a major role. And particularly for GCEK at the Rural Orissa, has played a lot of role in innovations, actually.
most of the participants may not be knowing actually that we tried to design a ambulance bike since a long time ago, which played a major role for carrying the patients from rural area to the city hospitals. It was actually the design guideline and everything was prepared by GCEK. And later on, the GCEK mechanical team also has filed a patent for carrying the patients in a stretcher, but the stretcher is a different type and all those things, and which is already in the pipeline for obtaining the design patent, and which will be definitely a innovative idea done by Dilip Bagal, who is the convener, and Ajit Patnaik. I hope definitely so many innovations will come and keep the GCEK head high. Wish you all the best and wish all the best for this seminar, a grand success. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Principal, sir, for your words, sir. May I request our head of the department, Dr. Mutunjay Rao, sir, to share his view and tell something about the department and the webinar. Sir, please, sir. Mutunjay Rao, sir.
Good morning, one and all present in this webinar. A hearty welcome to all of you. Respected Vice Chancellor, Dr. C.R. Tripathi, sir, Principal Dr. Dulu Patnaik, and the Tech-Up Coordinator of our college, Dr. C.R. Das, and heads of the different departments. Parag Bhargav, and Dr. Chinmay Kara, my dear colleagues, students, and faculty participants from various institutes. In this occasion, I would like to inform you that the purpose of this workshop is to provide you a platform to learn, understand, and analyze the importance of innovation that is required for a product design and the different types of sustainability, clean manufacturing processes that are adopted in various industries. And coming to our department, the undergraduate course of the Department of Mechanical Engineering was started in the year 2009 with an intake capacity of 60 students. And with the passage of time, the intake capacity has been increased to 120 in the year 2015. And in addition to that, we have also opened a postgraduate course program in the specialization of thermal engineering from 2015. The department organizes this type of seminars, conferences, workshops under the TECU project regularly around the year. And that's why we are very much thankful to the TECU NPIU for providing also the funds for this type of activity. In the last year, we have also conducted one conference and one seminar in thermal engineering. And the conference that is in association with the Department of Basic Science in Material Science. So the theme was Material Science. And for this webinar, we have invited Dr. Parag Bhargav, the professor of Department of Metallurgical Engineering and Material Science, IIT Mumbai, and Dr. Chinmay Kara, the industrial expert from SAFCO, Dubai, to enlighten all the participants regarding the various aspects of innovation in product design and sustainable manufacturing processes. We have a lot of learners registered for this webinar. It is around 700. But I am extremely sorry that we cannot provide them all here, accommodate in this platform. So we have, our team has already made the YouTube live streaming for the remaining participants. There they can watch the total was the screaming through YouTube. And as we know that our Indian economy is based on this manufacturing and agriculture, but our discussion here is only manufacturing. So I want to tell you that we, the Indians, are very good in manufacturing, but we want to see India as a manufacturing hub in the globe. So our main focus is in manufacturing is that we are manufacturing the product, we are assembling the product, but where we are lagging is the design of the product. So that is the thing we need to think about that. So our design approach has to be changed or refined so that we can meet the global needs, and our engineer have to become self-sufficient and self-reliant in the design of the best possible product. This is what our aim in this webinar to the participant. By our experts, they will tell details. So with this much of introduction, I want to wrap up, because we have a lot of activities to carry out. So once again, I would like to thank our team members, the convener of this webinar, Dr. Professor Dilip Kumar Bagal, and Professor Ajit Kumar Patnaik for organizing, and his team also for organizing this webinar. And the last but not the least, all the participants, those who are present here, and they take time from out of their schedule and remain with us during this whole day. And finally, I would like to thank the TechU coordinator for the financial support to provide us to organize this seminar. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I request to TechU coordinator, Dr. C.R. Das, to brief about TechU and the related activities. Please, sir.
Good morning, all. Honorable principal, sir, heads of the department, the other faculty members and dignitaries present over the meeting, students of our college and from other institutions also, and Professor Parag Bhargav from IIT Bombay and Dr. Chinmay Kar from SAFCO Dubai. So today actually it is immense pleasure, because so far during this lockdown we have conducted near about 10 to 12 webinars, conference seminars for the students and faculties. But first time our vice chancellor able to give us some time for us, time period, because he remains so busy. So for this reason I would like to thanks to our principal sir, because he has taken the effort. And mechanical department has organized the first webinar during this lockdown. So I would like to thanks to the conveners, Professor Dilip Bagal, Ajit Patnaik, and head of the department, Nutsinya Raut, for this. Basically, this is the department in our college actually which is well equipped in its laboratories, and they are also providing good research papers in international journals. They are providing large number of papers in comparison to other departments also. And regarding this college, we are being funded by TechU. In the last stage, we have been considered in 2017 that will be funded as a focus institute by NPIU. And it is a great pleasure that although the institute is very new, started in 2009, but during 2019, we are able to achieve NBA accreditation in one of the department. And regarding other departments, we are trying to achieve this target also. But the criteria of faculty student ratio creates certain problems for us, and we are trying our level best. Principal is taking our effort to rectify. That means to go for the appointment of different faculty members with the help of the university. And this webinar will give the immune boost of to our students and other dignitaries present in the meeting. And the number of registered participants in the webinar is also high. And also
simultaneously
in YouTube. And it is last time that we are streaming live in YouTube. And this effort is taken by also these three fellows. Rupinder Rao, Dilip Bagal and Ajit Patel. Thank you for this live streaming. And lastly, I will thanks to all the dignitaries present over here, and special thanks to Parag Bhargav sir, because I heard about him from our colleagues, from my colleagues Ajit Patnaik, when he has visited to IIT Bombay. And regarding Dr. Chinmay Karo, he is well associated with many of the faculties of our college. And personally also I know him, but he might have not known me. So I hope Luna will give will, the outcome of the winner is fruitful to every individual. Thanks to all.
So, thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable words. Good morning to all. I hope all are safe and doing well. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Deputy Odisha, Professor C.R. Tripathi sir, Honorable Principal, Professor Dilip Patnaik sir, respected speaker, Professor Bhargav from IIT Bombay, Dr. Chinmay Karo, industry expert from Saudi Arabia, Secretary of Mechanical Department, Dr. Mutanjay Rao, PhD academic, Dr. K.C. Panda sir, Security Coordinator, Dr. Yadav, my co-convener, Professor Ajit Kumar Patnaik sir, dear colleagues, faculty members from other colleges, registrar, my dear faculty members and participants from different industries. On the organizing team of IPDSM 2020, I welcome all of you to this one-day webinar on innovation in product design and sustainable manufacturing organized by the Department of Mechanical Engineering. During the COVID-19 pandemic, there are many challenges regarding the conduct of online classes, seminars, conference and workshop, but it as well gives the opportunity to all the all to explore the online platform to get rid of it. The webinar is planned to give the light to the students and faculty members about the innovation in product design and sustainable manufacturing. And not taking much of your time, I would like to introduce today's chief guest speaker, the August gathering, busy sir, and he has given wonderful speech about this webinar. So I want to give brief about Chittaranjan Tripathi sir. Our beloved Professor Dr. Chittaranjan Tripathi sir takes charge of Vice Chancellor of Biju Patnaik University of Technology, Rourkela, on 8th of October 2017. Previously, BC sir has served Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University. He was designated a professor at the age of just 38. Making him the youngest person in Odisha. Dr. Tripathi got both his M.Tech degree in instrumentation and PhD degree in computer science from IIT Kharagpur in the year 1989 and 1997 respectively. In addition to that, he has teaching experience of 35 years along with 14 years in the field of administration of educational institute like dean, principal, vice chancellor. His current research area are in the areas of parallel computing, optical and wireless networking, multi-processor architecture, parallel and distributed processing, performance evaluation, cloud computing, reliability and fault tolerance. He has published more than 120 papers in these areas. He mainly received reversed conferences and reputed journals, including Elsevier, West Ranger. More than 10 scholars have been awarded PhD under his guidance, and he has cited by 8 index of 14, I-10 index of 18, and the Google Scholar index. Sir received numerous awards, but I read out few of them, such as he received a medal for best research paper published in the year 2008 by Computer Division, Institute of Engineers, India. Best Journal Award in 2004 by Electronics and Telecommunication Division, Institution Engineers, India. Then Best Journal Award in 2002 by Computer Division, by Association of Engineers, India. Then Sir Thomas Ward Memorial Gold Medal in the year 1998. Then Best Journal Paper Award in the year 1997 by Electronics and Telecommunication Division of Institution of Engineers, India. Besides this, Leading Scientist of the World 2010 is one of them by the International Biographical Center, Cambridge, England. Our speaker of first session, Professor Dr. Parag Bhargav sir, who is professor from IIT Bombay. Dr. Bhargav sir now working as a professor in the Department of Metallurgical Engineering and Material Science, IIT Bombay. He has completed his doctoral degree from IIT Bombay. Sir pursued his MS degree and PhD in the material science from the University of Alabama. Sir has done postdoctoral research at Rutgers University. He's teaching at the IIT for over 20 years, guided over more than 20 PhDs and over 90 master theses. Professor Bhargav's group has worked in the powder processing or powder metallurgy, near net shape forming of advanced ceramics, stereolithography of ceramics, fused deposition of ceramics, indentation structure of ceramics, protein coagulation casting, that is PCC of ceramics, gel casting, rheology of concentrated ceramic suspensions, fabrication and properties of ceramic forms, synthesis of weakly agglomerate nanoparticles, consolidation of nanoparticles, fabrication of ceramic for prosthodontic application, plastic forming of ceramics, development of high temperature foam, fiber-based thermal insulation, materials for dye sanitized and probiotic solar cell. In the recent times, his group has also initiated work on development of silver paste for solar PV applications with support from Tata Center for Technology and Design at the IIT Bombay. He has published around about 150 research articles and have 5 patents granted by US and 1 pending. He co-founded 3 companies, first one Ant Ceramics, that is a ceramic manufacturing venture, and it has a website of antceramics.com, which is incubated with a joint support of IIT Kharagpur and IIM Ahmedabad, CIE. Then the second one, Matwich Materials, which is incubated in Sign IIT Bombay, a manufacturer of lab equipment, also involved in development of MedTech products. Then third one he co-founded is Digitent LPP, which is a dental lab manufacturing dental prosthesis. He was awarded Young Engineer of the Year award by the INAE in the year 2002, silver medal for technology-based commercialized innovation at Incubus Innovation 05, which is organized by IIM Ahmedabad in the year 2005. First prize inter-IIT competition on new environments for learning, teaching, digital resources, pan-IIT meet Mumbai in the year 2006. Excellence in teaching award at IIT Bombay in the year 2008 and 2016. The Chevening Rolls-Royal Science, Innovation and Leadership Crips Fellowship Award at Said Business School that in Oxford University, UK in the year 2015. He had delivered many social talks like TEDx talk in YouTube. He developed an app for the malnutrition, which is available on the Play Store, named as Smart Health Baby. And he is running libraries for the underprivileged in plans around IIT campus. Our second speaker of this webinar is Dr. Chinmay Gora, who is industry consultant from Saudi Arabia. I want to give a brief about him. Dr. Chinmay Gora has completed his postdoc in mechanical engineering from INSA Lyon, France in the February 2006. Dr. Kora has completed his PhD doctorate degree from IIT Kharagpur in September 2005. He has completed M.Tech in Industrial Engineering and Management from IIT ISM Dhanbad in the October 1997. He has completed his Bachelor in Engineering from IGIT Utkal University in December 1992. Dr. Chinmay Gora had a working experience from multinational companies like Safco, SABIC, South Arabia, Honeywell Technology Solution, General Electric Global Research, Crompton Greaves Limited in R&D, faculty position in Gandhi Institute of Engineering Technology, Odisha, then College of Engineering and Technology, that is CET Bhubaneswar, Odisha. He received awards and recognition like a Honeywell Fellow, which is a highest technical position in Honeywell company at Bangalore. He got Erasmus Mundus Fellowship from European Commission, INSA, Lyon, France. Also, he had received the Honeywell TS Annual Innovation Award along with other team and individual awards as per Google Scholar Indexing. His research papers are cited and got H index of 11 along with I10 index of 12 during his research career. Dr. Chinmay Gora has 10 patents which are of granted patents at US along with other 20 plus patents in various fields. Char has 3 trade secrets also at Honeywell. He is certified as a vibration analyst. CAT3 US Vibration Institute. Dr. Kora has advanced RCM facilitator from Meridium and got Six Sigma Green Belt at Honeywell. He has more than 14 reputed journals, and out of which 4 international journals are considered as hottest articles. Furthermore, he has attended more than 20 conferences and invited lecturers. His areas of interest are based on conditions like vibration, noise, motor current, performance monitoring, machinery fault diagnostic and prognostics, reliability analysis, RCM, Six Sigma and data analysis. So now I would like to invite Dr. Dulu Patnaik, principal, to welcome the guest and share his views regarding the webinar. Please, sir.
Hi, on behalf of GCEK and from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, welcome our experts to this webinar, and hope your ideas and expertise will definitely illustrate it well, and wish this webinar a grand success, and I request you to start the webinar at the earliest. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Without taking much of our time, we'll straight away moving to the session one. It will be delivered by Professor Dr. Parag Bhargav sir. So Parag Bhargav sir, please share the PPT, sir. Please.
Okay. Thank you. I'll do that, and let me know once you start. So I would begin first of all with thanking you all and Professor Ajit also to get in touch with me and invite me for this presentation, and a nice opportunity to sort of interact with you and talk to you and share my thoughts. I read a little bit about your college and also heard just now that you are a young college. So that way it is interesting and important that, you know, you have been organizing all these seminars even during this lockdown period for the benefit of your colleagues and students. I have tried to put in, I looked at this seminar or the webinar theme, and I've tried to, link it closely, I hope. But of course, my specific examples are related to material science and metallurgy with some flavor of manufacturing. Hopefully, you'll be able to gain something from it. And I have also, included some general motivational kind of ideas also to share with you. Now, also, before I begin, I just wanted to say that with whatever my background, I should honestly say that I'm still learning, right? What is innovation, the process of innovation, the process of product development, and all those things, still like a student, despite having done a few things. So I've titled this presentation as The Journey Towards Product Development, Inspiration, Ingredients, and Case Studies. So hopefully you see all of these keywords in the presentation. We definitely need inspiration before we start doing anything. The ingredients being, the knowledge, maybe some methodology, some standard operating procedures. And then I also have shared some of my own, experiences here. I'll begin, and I begin immediately with sort of a, like a question or a thought for all of you. That, when we are talking of manufacturing, innovation, product design, and I think it was told probably by the principal of the college that while we are good at manufacturing, the design of products, the designing of products in India is maybe not up to the mark. But I have this question that in terms of India, and that to something which impacts a lot of people, right? Large number of people. Can we think of products which have been entirely developed in India and sold all over the world? And of course, it is very important to think about this primarily because of, the economy and its impact on society. If we are able to design, develop and manufacture world-class products in India, and if we are able to sell them all over the world, which means we are able to export them, then it impacts our economy positively. And of course, then has its impact on society. So overall development, overall quality of life improves if we are able to do this, right? Now, I want to show you maybe some, very quickly some data which I've been sharing with many people. This is, if you can see on your screens, this is what is called the balance of trade data. So this balance of trade data here, the top one is for Germany. And what this balance of trade means that this is the difference between the export and import value for a country, right? I just said that wish in India could export a lot of products, right, which we are, which we make ourselves in the country. So this is a little older data. I have it from before. This is from 2018. And if you notice this one, for example, this is for the month of June for Germany right now. And this shows that the blue color shows, or this is positive number. This shows that Germany had an excess of export over import of about 22 billion euros, which is a very large number. And if you see for the entire year, if you calculate for 1 year, a country like Germany, which may be almost same size or slightly bigger, I don't know, than Orissa, but that country every month has an excess of something like on an average of about 20 billion euros of net, you know, net revenues, I mean, in terms of difference between import and export. So they are exporting much more. And we, all of us, are aware, I have known from my childhood, that Germany is like an engineering, you know, powerhouse. They make a lot of engineered goods.
Hello?
And they are very strong in engineering, and they export. India, of course, as it was mentioned, India is making a lot of things for itself. But in terms of economics, if we see economics, and I think that way, Kalahandi, although now, as I read, Kalahandi district has been catching up. But Kalahandi, for example, earlier was sort of known to be one of the sort of, you know, the economically backward districts. But now I think it has been coming up in the recent times. But in general, what I'm trying to say is,
Excuse me, sir. Sorry to disturb you. Sir, your present screen is not visible, sir, actually. The initial screen is there.
You mean the title only?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is showing only the title screen.
Oh, just 1 second. Sorry.
Yes, sir. Now, yes, sir. It is showing, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is the third slide.
Okay. Well, okay. So let me do one thing, if you don't mind, since I came out. See, I have a, is it okay if I have a small online 5-minute survey? Shall I share it with participants, the link?
Okay, sir.
Quickly, and then I'll continue, because that's a very short one. Just one moment, I will unshare and come back. Okay, just a minute. So just a minute, I will.
Certificate we will issue, sir.
Sorry?
Certificates, sir, after webinar.
I'll put it in the chat, and if participants can, okay, I put it in the chat. Is that it must have come, right? So if participants can fill this 5-minute questionnaire at any point of time, you know, these are just a few clicks. Okay, now I'll go back to share my presentation. Just a minute. Are you able to see now?
Yes, sir. Hello? Yes, sir. Your screen is visible.
So you are seeing the presentation, right?
No, sir. The presentation is not visible, actually, sir.
Just 1 second.
Sir. Your entire screen is visible.
Sir, your presentation is not visible.
Just a minute. I shared the... 1 second. Sorry. Sorry, just one moment. Now? Hello, can you see it now?
Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay. So I'm going to go to presentation mode.
It's, yes, sir.
Still visible, right? Everything is okay?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what I was saying was, see, this is what I was saying. This shows the balance of trade for Germany from 2017-18. And every month, Germany, because they are a major exporter of engineered goods, for example, in the month of June, they had roughly 22 billion euros of net export over import, the difference. Okay. And I was saying, while India, we are doing well in terms of manufacturing, but still our economy is not that strong, as is, you know, well known. We still have a lot of poverty, still a lot of, you know, social issues, economic inequalities. And that is visible from here also. For India, in July 2018, if you can see, that it is a negative number, which means we were importing almost, the difference is about $18 billion in the month of July 2018. So in general, in India, we have been importing much more than exporting. And if we could do something similar to Germany, right, if we could export more, then our economy is going to improve. And the reason I'm showing this data is it is all connected to product development, right? Product design, development, innovation. So if we do better and better in those terms, we could attempt to do things how Germany, how a country like Germany, I'm just taking it as an example, not necessarily Germany, any other country can also be an example. Now I'm going to switch to the next slide. So what I'm trying to show in the next slide is when your country is economically strong, for example, like this, you know, did the screen change now? Hello?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Oh, so I will exit the presentation mode. Maybe that is, I don't know why it's a problem, that means. So I'll exit the presentation mode. How about this now?
Yes, visible, sir.
Yeah, so I'll just stay in this mode only, because I don't know why when I start presenting in that mode, it doesn't show. So what I was trying to say is when you have a very strong economy in terms of greater exports than imports, then the infrastructure, you know, these are some real pictures from Germany, right? Our infrastructure can look good. We will not have economic inequalities. Our poverty can come down and, you know, quality of life can really improve. Now, in terms of, again, the balance of trade data over the years, if you see for Germany, this is the zero line, okay? And from early on, they were, you know, they had a balance of trade, but somewhere in the 70s and 80s, this country, Germany, picked up, and you can see the dramatic rise in their economy, you know, how much they started exporting. Okay, and that is all, you know, roughly, this is around that 20 billion euro kind of a mark. But for India, what has happened is from whatever 1960s, until 1990s, we were, or 1990s, or even up to 2000, we were like a, we had a balance of trade. So we were, you know, it's the zero line here. So we were importing as much as we were exporting. But over a period of time, in the last maybe, you know, 20 years, what we have seen is a lot more import than export. And we know why, because, I mean, there are, for example, one of the examples is all electronics. And some of us, or some of you, would have also read that, you know, electronics import contributes to a lot of our, you know, import. So we have now gone to negative numbers, which of course impacts our economy, and we have, that means, lesser money in the country, or we are not as strong economically. And here is some more, very quickly, some more data. This is in 1960, the per capita GDP, like sort of a per person GDP, or the value of goods and services in India, from India, in US dollars in 1960s was $655. South Korea, I just have taken because that's a young economy that way, was $1,103. And China was much lesser than us, only $132 in 1960. And this is 2015. China has dramatically, you know, increased. We are still, you know, very low. I think the recent figure from 2020 is somewhere around $1,800 to $1,900 per capita. It would have come down now. But look at South Korea. See, South Korea jumped dramatically. It came down to, it came up to $25,000 in 2015. Okay, it is almost as good as any European country, or for example, the US. So it is well known for South Korea, it's a small country, and well known why they are such a, you know, they saw such a large increase in the GDP, simply because they did work very hard in terms of their manufacturing in all advanced technologies. They did a lot of, you know, emphasis on education and research. And we use in India a lot of Korean products. Many of our cell phones, our washing machines, our televisions, cars are from South Korea. So they're, look at their GDP, and they export all over the world now. So making products and exporting them all around the world is in a way the key to becoming economically stronger. Of course, that making things in India for ourselves, because it saves our, are important for us people, like, I mean, for us engineers as well, you know, to understand, because this becomes our motivation. Can we actually match? I mean, imagine if this is the kind of GDP, and I've visited Korea personally, the country looks now very different probably from when it looked in 1960s. There are no problems in terms of, you know, poverty, malnutrition, and quality of life is very good, you know, a lot of good facilities for every citizen of the country. So this becomes a motivation. That's why I was saying we all need some kind of motivation, inspiration to sort of, you know, move ahead. Now, another thing I'm saying is, you may say that, look, how can I do it? How can I'm just one individual. How can I do anything like this? You know, so although I agree that we must all work together as a collective, right, as a group, you know, come together throughout the country to do things which improve, you know, our economic status through engineering. But at the same time, what I wanted to say was, even individuals, you know, there are examples within our country that even one person generally can become a strong, you know, powerful motivator, or you know, and can inspire many, many people, you know, to make a big difference to the country. All of us are aware of ISRO, and all of us, I think, know that Vikram Sarabhai was sort of, you know, solely responsible. Of course, he had the support of all his other team members, but he was one person who had all this, you know, inspiration in himself, and he passed it on to others, and sort of ISRO became what it is, right? And all of us are in some sense proud of where ISRO stands today. And similarly, in terms of atomic energy, it has done a lot for the country, given a lot of confidence and strength to the country. And this person, Homi Bhabha, was again responsible for sort of initiating in the early days and building up the team and building up all the, you know, the ecosystem for BARC to flourish, or the Department of Atomic Energy to flourish. And of course, the government supported them. And then in a completely different segment, you know, I hope all of you have heard of Varghese Kurien. And if you have not heard of him, I'm sure you have heard of Amul. So Varghese Kurien, this person was a mechanical engineer, actually. So it directly, you know, relates to all of you who are mechanical engineers. And, you know, he was from Kerala, but imagine in those days, 50s and 60s, he settled in rural Gujarat, and he made this happen again with, of course, a lot of other support and team, but he was one of the prime movers, and he made Amul what it is today. So at times, what I'm trying to say is, even though we have to work in a group, we have to have teams, but you have to believe in the power of one person also. It is not that nobody should think. So if you all are sitting in Kalahandi, and for example, you know, you may say that, look, I don't have all those kind of resources and, you know, all those whatever access to many other things. But here, Varghese Kurien was sitting in rural Gujarat, and probably that time, resources were not as great in the country in general in 1950s and 60s, but still he led these efforts. And this is true for all of these people. So I think they were very, very motivated, okay, and driven by something internally to make all this difference. You know, in Amul in 2018-19, the revenues were 38,000 crores. And this makes a difference. That is why you see that, you know, people who are involved with Amul, the farmers who sort of are associated with Amul, have steady incomes and I'm sure better quality of life than when, you know, people are poor. And I'm just trying to relate you to this one sort of quote from Swami Vivekananda. And he, I think in some sense, he may not be exactly these words, but sometime I think he stated that, give me 100 energetic young men and women. Sorry, I mean, it's worded, but I don't mean to say young men and women, young people, basically, if you have 100 young people, he said that he can, if he had those 100 energetic young men and women, he could have transformed India. And I still believe in it. When you see these people here, right, just three people had so much impact in terms of all kinds of, you know, impact, including economic impact on the country. So imagine if we had 100 such people, I think India will just transform. And these people can come from anywhere, right? From any part of the country, and resource constraint is not really the reason why people cannot come up. It's the inspiration. That's what I've been trying to say. Okay, so I'm going to move to the next slide. Now I'm going to show you something different, you know. It's very, very different from whatever I've been talking about. But I told you... Sorry? Hello? You can see slide number 9, right?
No, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's visible, sir. Slide number 9.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm now sharing some other thoughts. See, but it is related. Like I've been saying, when I gave you an example of Germany... So Germany or South Korea, for example, or even China now, all of them, you know, improved their education system, and they worked on both early primary education, secondary, all those things. But they also worked on their university systems and did a lot of quality research. But one difference I think that they did compared to us in India is that all of these countries, not only they did research, but they took their research out of their labs and developed products, very sophisticated, advanced products. So I've taken an example from Scopus, you know, just a search engine, right, for journal articles. And I have searched for OLEDs. OLEDs mean organic light emitting diodes, which are used in TVs, phones, everywhere, right? These are display devices. So I have searched for researchers in India, Indian researchers who have worked on OLEDs. So these are, for example, these people have worked on related, not OLED. This is organic solar cells. But
slide not visible properly, sir.
Slide is not visible.
Yes, sir.
1 second.
No, sir, it is visible. You have to beam that one. Sorry. Yeah, don't disturb. Okay.
Okay.
You have to beam that one. Okay.
It is visible, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so what I was trying to say was I had searched on Scopus for researchers who are working on organic display materials, organic light emitting diodes, or for example, solar cells. And the important thing is, see, here are many of these articles have Indian researchers. This is an Indian group. Here is an Indian group. Here are some Indian researchers, and they have very high number of citations, right? You can see almost 550 citations, 250 citations and all that. And while our researchers are working on organic light emitting diodes with very high citations, but somehow in India, we have not been able to manufacture organic light emitting diodes or these display devices yet. So this is, even though we should agree, we should realize our strength. We are doing good research, you know, having good publications with citations, but somehow we need to also try to convert our research into products, which is anyway one of the themes of your seminar here. So anyway, I'll move on. Just wanted to say it as an example. And this is not just the only case. There are many such cases where we have done good research in the country, but we have not always been able to convert it into a product. And we need to sort of think about it and, you know, make changes wherever needed. Okay, I've gone to the next slide now. So I'm just talking about research, again, impact of research. So as per some journal rankings, India ranks 5th in the global research publication output, so which is very good, right? So we that's what I was saying, that we do good research, we publish good research, okay? But as I said, what we need to think about is also how to convert that into products, okay? Now, countries, the other countries which are there, of course, other than India, is US, China, Germany, and UK, and they continue to dominate world rankings in both quantitative and qualitative research. Only thing, I as I said, and this is repeated here, it's written, mentioned here in this point, that the work reported in publications being put to practical use is low in India. It needs to increase significantly. And why should we bother about that? Like I said, if we start doing it, our economy will become stronger. If we can export more, then we will see the all-round development of the country, right? So I move on to the next point. Even if we, when I say that we should develop products, you know, from our research, but I think it is still true for our country that the innovation ecosystem, so to say, see, even as an individual, yes, I may try a lot of things, but every country needs an ecosystem, you know, for converting research to products. So that innovation ecosystem is what I'm referring to here. So, for example, most of you are familiar with in the US, for example, Silicon Valley is sort of, you know, leads by example. They have a great innovation ecosystem where all these, you know, technology companies keep coming up. Not only the researchers, not only good ideas, but there is a lot of people who are looking for good ideas to invest in them. And then all the other systems that are needed. And similarly, maybe not as great, but still similar examples are seen in Singapore. I gave you example of South Korean economy. And for example, China, you know, certain areas which are very good. Shenzhen is well known for such ecosystem. And this ecosystem in India, we are attempting, of course, we are, you know, there's a lot of now discussion, but we need to build it up in India, right? And that, and we are all part of that ecosystem. Okay. So each individual, as I said earlier, matters. Now, once we are able to do that, then I think we'll be able to have many more success stories of, you know, make in India or products with that are made in India and are, you know, sort of sold all over the world. Okay. This is again an example as a result of research. And if you have good ecosystem, what all can happen? So this is an old number, old data. But in 2000, Samsung was not into, you know, any of these advanced high-tech products. They were more of a shipbuilding and kind of a construction-based company. But in 2014, Samsung's revenues were $200 billion, okay, which is a very big number. $1 billion, as you would know, is about 7,000 crore rupees, okay. So this is a very big number, which was just one company was 17% of South Korea's GDP, okay. And look at all these numbers. R&D spending of Samsung in 1 year annual is about $13 billion, which is like something like 90,000 crore rupees. Okay, so this company spends 90,000 crore rupees on R&D in 1 year. And I think 90,000 crore rupees may be a very large fraction, if not entire, of our, you know, academic higher sort of budget for the higher education institutions. For example, I think IIT Bombay budget may be, if I'm not wrong, but it is about 1,000, maybe 1,500 crores. But imagine one company spending 80,000 crore rupees per year. And look at the number of researchers they have. 63,000 researchers, 42 research facilities. I don't think we can imagine that kind of thing. But what I want to tell you is, you should not feel bad. Rather, you should find inspiration from this. That if in India we build such companies, then, you know, of course, we can also do such things. But, you know, we need to be inspired by such things. We should not feel bad, but we should be inspired that, okay, we can also attempt. And as I said, every individual, you know, can make a difference. Okay. In India, of course, in comparison, the R&D spending is very low. In 2000, again, old data, but, you know, in 2009-10, the 100 biggest Indian companies had a spending of about 11,500 crores, as in contrast to, you know, this spending. So in general, Indian companies don't spend that much on R&D, and that, you know, it is very important that you have the money to spend on R&D, only then you can develop products. So you cannot develop products that way. I mean, at least take them through to the final step if you don't have the financial resources, right? So everything is linked. Basically, if you innovate, if you develop better things, better products, build strong companies, you can do all of this. Now, I'm just, you know, showing you something which all of you are familiar with. And I said that research plays an important part in all, doing all of this, right? I've been saying this in last few slides. And generally speaking, when we do research, we could have either goals which are purely academic, right? Based on curiosity, to have some intellectual satisfaction, or to improve existing knowledge. But the other thing which we are talking about in this webinar is product, right? So that is, that comes under applied research. So the other goals of research always is, why should I do, you know, applied research? Primarily to better our lives, you know, in terms of comfort, security and happiness. or to improve product quality, you know, make better products, make newer products, and thus, you know, have all that other impact which I said in terms of economy and, you know, all-round development in the country. Now, I come to one very important point. I feel this is a learning from my own sort of, you know, experiences that I've had for last 20, 22 years. That when we think of applied research, I just said applied research, and when we talk of the theme of the symposium, for example, product development, design, innovation, the first step that I feel, you know, and I'm including myself, okay, so I'm not pointing to others, but I'm saying I have made these mistakes. I want to point out this mistake, and I think all of us should learn from this, as I said, you know, that I'm still learning. That if I want to work on applied problems or if I want to develop products, the most important thing which I should know, and I should not make this mistake, is that often as researchers, and I've done this in my you know, previous years many times, is that I defined the problem statement without talking to the stakeholders. Okay. So it's a very big mistake if we do not talk to the stakeholders, and if we believe that we know the problem very well or we have identified the problem correctly. Okay. So, for example, I've just put this picture only as an example. Okay. And you can imagine if these pictures are of, I mean, they are not taken from, say, Orissa or Kalahandi, but imagine if in your district, if these pictures refer to farmers in Kalahandi, right? And if here I am a professor sitting in my, you know, office, and I'm saying, okay, I'm going to identify some problems which these people face, right? So if I'm sitting in my office and trying to identify problems of these farmers, I think I'm making, what I'm trying to say is I'm making a very big mistake. What I mean to say is, if I want to identify problems of these farmers, let's say in Kalahandi, then I need to go and meet, or our students need to go and meet these farmers, right? And I need to understand from them what are their problems, instead of thinking that I know what their problems are. Okay, I don't know whether you agree. This may seem a very simple point, but I'm telling you, this is one of the most important points in trying to define the problem for your research. And if you define your problem correctly, if you talk to 100 farmers, let's say in Kalahandi, and if you want to help the farmers, and if you talk to 100 farmers or maybe of different economic status, maybe farmers who hold different sizes of lands, maybe farmers who do different kinds of crops, all those things, you will develop such rich understanding of their problems that when you come back to your college or to your office and you have discussion with your students or among yourself, you will identify those problems so well. And finally, when you do research, you will develop something which the farmers will want. Okay. And what is a product? A product is nothing but something which needs to be, you know, which somebody values and is willing to pay for it, right? So this is why I'm saying I felt that many times I made this mistake in my research in my early days, and I learned it very late. So I'm now trying to practice this more and more, that if I want to work on something, let's talk to the stakeholders. And stakeholders could be customers, they could be industries, they could be like people, like farmers, I said, or they could be just simply consumers. Okay, so if we make this mistake, this is the problem that happens. Very often, our problem statements chosen are of the kind for whose solution nobody is waiting for. For example, if I guide my student to do some research, you know, some thesis is produced. If I did not identify the problem correctly, nobody is interested to read this thesis. You know, this thesis will just stay in my, you know, in my shelf in my office, right? So I wanted you, all of you, to think about this, that defining the problem should be done by talking to stakeholders. And I have more examples of that. So I've gone to the next slide. The next slide here, again, related point, that if we are trying to do industrial product development, okay, it is possible only when researchers, like people like us, work closely over several years. Okay, we should not think, okay, we should work, continue to do that association continuously. I mean, have that association over years, right from the beginning when we start till we are able to finish it. And the people we should remain associated with is potential customers, because they will give you the right feedback. Okay, right? And domain experts. So for example, sometimes what happens is I think I know everything. Okay, but sometimes if we are able to talk to the experts, they will give us good feedback, and I can continuously, you know, sort of channelize and redirect my research, and any other stakeholders. So what I'm trying to say here is this requires the right mindset for collaboration. I have sometimes made that mistake that I thought I will do everything. Okay. It's not possible, particularly when you develop products. Okay. When you do applied research, it's very important to collaborate. And I have made that mistake sometimes and I've realized how much difference it makes. Okay. So this is one challenge. The other challenge is, you know, we always sort of not realize all of this. And we, you know, like I was saying, you know, for example, I'm in IIT Bombay, maybe I'm just sitting, you know, it's a nice campus and I sort of don't want to move out of my comfort zone. So often because of that, I make all those mistakes, you know, staying put in campus, I don't go meet stakeholders, I don't talk to collaborators, but I think it's very important to make ourselves uncomfortable, okay? I should be willing to go, you know, travel, to talk to farmers, to visit industries, to talk to these industrial people, to talk to customers, you know, to talk to some manufacturers, all that. So I should be willing to do that. Otherwise, you know, it becomes a problem and we will never get the right thing happening. Even if I'm the best of the researcher, okay? So this is, I hope you got the message. Now, one slide, this is not my slide really in terms of the input. There's a center called GDC, I think Gopalakrishnan Deshpande Center in IIT Madras, and they run some very interesting programs for people who are interested in product development. So they work with teams, you know, and some of you who are interested, you can visit their website. And some of my students participated in a program from GDC IIT Chennai. But I took this slide from them that they stated that 90% of Indian startups fail within 5 years. And they said the biggest reason, okay, this one, the biggest reason is building something that nobody wants. Just imagine how, what kind of miss, what should I say, you know, that basically a waste of time and resources. If you build something that nobody wants, and why does it happen? Because very early on, we did not go and talk to potential customers or potential users, right? Or any other stakeholders. So very, very important before you start doing your research, okay? Or define your problem statement. Now, another example I'm taking, not again, this is from an industry. There is a company called 3M. I hope you have heard of this company. It's a very large American company. It has presence in India. And this is a document which is available on the internet, A Century of Innovation. This is the story of 3M, how 3M came up about 100 years from, I think, 1900 to 2000. And this is a statement from their this document. That, you know, the things that were very important to them. And I will show you in the next slide how many products this company makes. And it's a very large company, okay? But the most important statement that I found in relevance to our discussion here is that they say that solving customer problems from across oceans and continents, because they are a multinational company, right? So they can say from across oceans and continents played a major role in how innovation flourished at 3M. Innovation is a theme of today's webinar, right? And this is one very important message that this company saw, you know, was continuously interacting with their customers. They were hearing to their customers. Imagine if companies don't bother about their customers or what they're complaining and all that. But here they were, they continuously listened to their customers, they welcomed their feedback, and they tried to solve the problems which customers faced. And that is what led to innovation. And you can imagine, when you are a company, you have products, the customer suggestions or customer complaints should be welcomed, and it's a very necessary or it's a very useful input for you to do innovation, okay? And the second statement they make, unrelated, not directly related, they say is the most important innovations that this company did often responded to unarticulated needs. Meaning, unarticulated means nobody asked for those things, but the company researchers themselves were thinking, what do people really need? Okay, so this is a more risky thing. Maybe when the companies are very experienced in innovation, then they can do it. You know, some unarticulated needs, nobody asked for them, and then these things become very big. I've just put a picture of Scotch-Brite, which we use, many of us use in kitchens, you know, in dishwashing, like bartan saaf karne ke liye, right? So this product is a product now sold all over the country. Of course, in a way, it is innovation, but it is not that complex an innovation that we in India could not have thought of. But once we did a small calculation with some children, I was sitting with some children in our libraries, and we did a small calculation based on the fact that maybe we buy some Scotch-Brite throughout the, in 1 year, if we buy Scotch-Brite of 50 to 100 rupees, and if we assume our population only, let's say, I think we assume that only if 1/4 of the families in India bought this, then this turnover of Scotch-Brite itself would be about 500 crores. Okay, so what I'm saying is simple innovations which are useful to people, okay, which fulfill the needs of people, lead to good revenues. And imagine if you have so much revenues, then you can afford to do much more of innovation because now you have all the revenues. This is the detail of 3M. The full expanded name of this company, which they don't use now so much, is Minnesota Mining and Manufacturing Company. They started in 1902, and all these are their products, you know, adhesives, advanced materials, molding, okay, everywhere, you know, they are in all these electronics and software, display, biotech, right? So many. Of course, they started with only one or two segments in 1902, and they have grown by innovation, okay? So 1902, something related to mechanical engineering, they were selling abrasives for grinding wheels, and now it has revenue, and I think this is few years old. Their revenues have crossed something like rupees 2 lakh crores and profit is over 32,000 crores. So you can imagine such a company, if you build starting from very small things, they have built such a large company and now nobody can stop them. They will always remain and they will come up with a lot of innovation because with so much profit, they can do a lot of R&D, right? This is one very important slide, I feel, because this is an experience from India and actually from IIT Bombay. A professor, his name is Professor B. Ravi from Mechanical Engineering, and he has a center called BETIC in IIT Bombay, and he's focused on one segment, which is medical devices, okay? And he, out of his own experience of maybe, I don't know, 10, 15 years or more, he suggests the following, and this is very important if you pay attention to this. In terms of product development, design and innovation, he has a good recipe, I should say, as I'm saying here. So where they start, okay, imagine if they have, if they are working on these biomedical devices. So first thing they do is they themselves, you know, whether professor or the students, they do what is called clinical immersion. Immersion, you know, means like you are dipping yourself in literally. So the students and even the other researchers or faculty, they go and meet lots of doctors, okay? That is what means clinical immersion. So you immerse yourself, you dip yourself, meaning you go to various hospitals, clinics, you meet doctors. So when the student is about to begin research, this is the first thing. Like I was saying earlier, you have to meet your stakeholders, the potential customers. So they don't define the problem themselves. They don't say, oh, I know everything, what product I have to make, you know, whether it is for some kind of surgical product, okay, or whether it is a prosthesis. They don't decide themselves. They go and meet the concerned people, okay? And they do this over a period of several weeks, and they do a lot of documentation. They write down, they take pictures, they record videos, okay? And after that, and I know this in detail because I'm involved with BETIC with Professor Ravi, that after they do all this, they come back, they discuss among themselves, they try to define the problems and the problem, how they understood by meeting all these people, and they again go back. They don't end there and validate it from the doctors that, or the users or the customers, that have we defined this problem correctly? Do we understand it correctly, as you know, as they would say? Once the problem definition has happened by meeting all these people, then they decide the specifications of the device. They say, okay, now I understand the problem. Now let me put down some specifications, okay? Whether this should apply so much pressure, or whether this should, you know, have this kind of a motor, okay, whether this should have some kind of a movable part, what kind of material should it use, everything they will define in terms of the specifications of the device. After they have this, now the problem is properly defined, the device specifications are available, they will now go to start designing. And they will design, of course, they can design on paper first, just simply rough drawings, go to, you know, CAD, all the CAD tools, you know, design it properly, okay? And then once their design is done, often they will again maybe go back to the doctors, okay? It's not shown here. They may go back to doctors, they may talk to them and talk to them, does this design look sensible to them. Okay, if not, improve it and all that. And once you have your detailed design, they go to rapid prototyping. So they don't directly start producing now. So they'll make a few components. They'll use all the additive techniques, you know, RP techniques. And then they will produce a working kind of a model, a prototype, right? And this working prototype, again, they will talk to the users. So you have to keep going back, like I was saying earlier. You should not, the connection is not shown here, but they do it all the time. So they go back and they say, okay, is this something that is satisfactory to them? If they get a green signal after all of this validation, then they go to pilot manufacture. And once they start pilot manufacturing, they will go to different kinds of testing, whichever is required based on that medical device. And as they go through testing, if they are happy, it's fine. Otherwise, they may come back and then finally put it to clinical trials. And after that, it can either be transferred or it can go to production. Okay. And if you have done so much, imagine if you have done all this, you will also find investors. Okay. So Professor Ravi's group has been very successful in doing all this. And this is very, very important to think about. Okay. And this is not just applicable to medical device. This you can apply to anything that you like. You can just replace this, but you still have to go to stakeholders and do this entire process. Right. So one of the things is that, you know, this again, this is slide coming from Professor Ravi only. So for only for medical devices, you know, there are they say that there are so many problems, and all of us, you know, you can identify this, for example, pulse oximeter, right? Right now, nowadays it is in use. So there are lots of problems, lot of things which we don't manufacture in India even now of that quality. And this is what it says here. Indian medical device market, very large, 48,500 crore rupees, and 80% is imported. Just imagine what a large opportunity. And I'm just saying it as an example. Don't think that there are no opportunities in other segments, but almost every segment you will find very large opportunity. And Indian expenditure in healthcare is still quite low in terms of GDP, 5%. Okay. While in US it's 18%. So it's going to grow only. Okay. And I should say one more thing, that Professor Ravi's group has already come up with, I think, some 15, 20 products which have been commercialized. And there are several companies that their group has come up in the last 5 years or so, 5 or 7 years. Okay. Now I'm going to switch to something else. I'm going to show you some opportunities and some case studies from our own work. Okay. Maybe some of you, the opportunities you are familiar with. One of the things now in IIT Bombay we are discussing a lot is these metal additive manufacturing technologies, and it has a lot to do with mechanical engineering. And this is just showing you all the different technologies that are available in additive manufacturing. And the most recent ones that I have seen, you know, earlier I saw powder bed fusion was a technique for manufacturing or prototyping and manufacturing metal parts by additive manufacturing. But the most recent ones is this DED, which is also called the direct energy deposition. And if you can see here, one of the things why direct energy deposition is gradually becoming popular is you can go to parts of the order of even meters, which nobody thought is possible with, you know, additive manufacturing, right? There may be some reduction in part complexity, but still it is not as limiting as we would think from this chart. But lots of interesting technologies coming up now. So this is one great opportunity. Of course, one can also think of building simple machines themselves to acquire some experience. So this is a slide on direct energy deposition, just to explain a little bit, because what I understand by talking to people in the industry is that powder bed, the additive manufacturing based on powder bed is sort of, you know, in a some way it is very limiting and quite expensive, and the build times are very slow. And you can't do multi-materials in that, okay? So there are some limitations with powder bed. Now, what happens, the beauty of this, okay, I'll first, since I said powder, I'll show you this schematic, if you can see here, that here is a schematic which shows you like a laser beam, and coaxially, there are these setup for supplying powders, okay, along with the laser beam. So as this whole setup, you know, this kind of a nozzle assembly with laser moves, it basically feeds the powder, and this laser literally melts it there and starts to deposit on the substrate. And then you can build layer by layer. You know that in additive manufacturing, you build things layer by layer. The other option is you can use a wire feeder. Now, I should say one more thing before I forget. There are now commercially available machines in which you have an option of at least 4 or 6 powder bins. Okay. So you have 4 or 6 powder bins and you can actually supply all those 4 or 6 powders simultaneously. So this is, as I said, in the powder bed machine, this is not possible. You have to have only bed of one type of powder or pre-mixed powder. But here you can keep varying this. You can increase amount of one powder, you can decrease the other or whatever, or you can make composites or you can make graded materials. So very, very, you know, versatile kind of technique. And the other similar thing, but the feed can be with wire. And these techniques have become very popular industrially because of this mix of materials possibility. And also you can make large parts. Now, instead of laser, you can also have similar thing coming, say wire feeder, but electron beam. The advantage is with electron beam, you don't have the issue of whether this laser light is going to be absorbed by that material or not properly. So electron beam makes it versatile. This is just a real picture of a machine where these and direct energy deposition is being used. I should say one more thing. Another advantage of direct energy deposition is you can make complex components from scratch, or you can take parts which are worn out or which have been in use and now you want to repair. So you can just go to that location and deposit the material. So it's a very good repair technology also for expensive components. Okay. These are some parts. For example, you know, here, this is a valve seat. So some cladding has been attempted by using this direct energy deposition. This is an automotive mold made out of corrosion resistant materials by direct energy deposition. This is an example, large part made out of multi-materials. Okay, it's not possible by other technologies, but these multiple different types of metallic materials have been used to make this part. And imagine this part, a rocket fuel tank, this can't be made easily by other techniques, which is hollow. So this has also been made by a direct energy deposition system. And this information was shared by a company called Instec. Okay, very, very interesting things you can do. Large parts, multiple materials simultaneously and all those things. This is an example from ceramic, again from additive manufacturing. But in ceramics, you don't melt those materials. You know, melting points are much higher and there are a lot of other issues. So these are two parts produced by additive manufacturing of ceramics. And earlier, it was not possible to make large parts in ceramics. But this is an investment casting core. And I think there's a HAL in Koraput which may be using these ceramic cores for investment casting. This is basically used to make turbine blades, to make them hollow. So you put a ceramic and you cast over it, right? So then you get a hollow casting and you remove this ceramic by leaching later on. And these are some dental implants which are made by these additive manufacturing. Earlier, we used to believe that it's not possible to manufacture, but this part can be made in 30 seconds per implant. So you can also use these for these machines for manufacturing. The technology has evolved. This is basically using ceramic particulate suspension in photopolymerizable resins. And it works on like an exposure. So one layer can be made without scanning, just simply by exposure, just like we do in photography. So you just expose, one layer is immediately, you know, cured, then you move to the next layer and like that you build the part. Okay. So very interesting technique, a lot of new opportunities in this area. Now I'm showing you one more opportunity, which is very, very common throughout the country now. So if you go for a dental treatment, this is what happens. Okay, if you go to a dentist, they will ask you, and if you need a crown or a cap, you know, over your teeth, so what they do is they ask you to bite into some soft material. So this is like a patient's jaw or the teeth impression has come into this. Once you get this, you cast, like it's called a dental stone or a dental plaster, you cast that into it and you get a positive. So this looks like exactly like your jaw. Now, the dentist sends this to a dental lab. The dental lab does this. And in the dental lab, then they put this into a 3D scanner. So here is a 3D scanner and then you get this image. Okay. And then you use some CAD/CAM kind of softwares to build digitally the tooth which is broken. Okay, so you digitally kind of build it, okay, over that broken tooth, right? And then once you have the digitally built tooth, then you know that part, you can get the STL files for it, right? The tool path. So you use those STL files and you send it over to these machines, which are the milling machines, okay? So you put these, for example, in this case, ceramics are the best materials for dental applications. This is zirconia. So that zirconia disc is put here and you have these milling machines. So they mill out the crown for the patient based on which tooth it will go to. So this is showing a disc, for example, in a dental lab where they have milled out crowns for, say, different patients. One crown maybe for one patient, okay? And once they do it, they take it for sintering and they put some layering materials and it just looks like a natural tooth. The only other thing, now technology has evolved. Now, if you go to a dentist, they may not ask you to do this also. They directly have a 3D scanner, which they can, you know, intraoral 3D scanner. So they'll directly, you know, ask you to open your mouth. And just this small scanner, beautiful device, you know, can directly give you this kind of a CAD file. You don't need to do all this now. And then from there, you can directly send it to this with some designing, okay? CAD CAM, you build it up and then you get the dental crown. So this is a technology now very popular throughout the country, and these zirconia crowns are the best crowns, you know, in terms of properties, which is what I'm showing here. Can I take some more time or am I running out of time? Hello?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, can I take some more time or am I out of time?
Yes, sir. You can take up to 30 minutes, sir.
Okay. So, see, this was, as I said, zirconia is the best material for dental applications, right? This is what is shown here, the same disc. But this disc is made out of zirconia powder, okay, nano powder. Now, interestingly, for you to note, Orissa is one of the states which has a lot of raw material for this kind of product, you know. I think the beach sands in Orissa, and there's a company called Oscom in Orissa, which I visited once. They mine this material, you know, from the beach sands. They purify, they process it. And this zircon or zirconium silicate, I think a part of it is exported outside. Okay, and there is no company in India which manufactures the zirconia nanopowder from starting from that zircon sand. Okay, but this is a very high value addition product that can be made if we attempt. So we have done some work in that area, okay? And I was just going to show you. So this is what is needed to make this. This is, we must make zirconia nanopowder, and these are the characteristics that it must have. This nanopowder must be dispersible in water very easily to make these spray-dried granules. Then these granules are taken and that disc is produced. And this must give us very high strength and fracture toughness, because we are going to put it as a crown, okay, which should not fracture very easily. It should last us for a long time, so high fracture toughness. And this powder must give us isotropic shrinkage. When I sinter, it must shrink uniformly so that I would have designed my crown bigger, then it shrinks and it will fit my, you know, teeth. So when I go to a dentist, it should fit perfectly. So these are some requirements, and we made it in our lab by co-precipitation, okay? But the more important part is, this anybody can do, but we tried it in quantities. Like in the next slide you are showing, I'm showing that this is like a semi-continuous reactor. We did all those kind of things. Then we used large volumes of this raw material, the zirconium oxychloride, which I said is made from zircon sand, beach sand, like in Orissa. And then we tried to purify this powder, you know, in all these, you know, including we used a washing machine to, you know, get rid of impurities, although it didn't work very well. And these are again some large scale, you know, industrial centrifuges. This is a filter press. All of these we used to synthesize nanoparticles. So at a lab scale, we got a very good product which could compete with the commercial. You know, this is our product. See, sintered, nice and dense sintered material with grain size less than 1 micrometer. And these are all commercial sintered materials. So our powder matches very well with all these. But we had some issues, and I'm still working on it to try to find some investment for setting up a pilot plant for making this zirconia nanopowders, which is where a lot of help is required from chemical engineers, mechanical engineers and all that, right, to translate it to a product. And another thing that happened is, because of this interest, one company got started. One of my students, you know, initiated that. This company is called Digident. It is based in Indore, and they do make all these dental crowns. They are not making the materials right now, but they are doing all the processing of making dental crowns for many different materials. And they have all these CAD-CAM machines and everything, you know, that one needs. Okay. This is another. Now I'm switching to different other opportunities or case studies. This is something recent. All of you would have had eaten this, you know, like candy floss sometime. And this is made using this machine, which is very low cost, some 12,000 rupees. Okay. But recently, one professor of Indian origin, Professor Manuk Prakash from Stanford University, he showed that you can use this machine, which has a heater. You know, generally what you do is you pour the sugar solution and there's a heater. So, you know, as it becomes viscous and as you spin this inside, it forms fibers. For example, you can see from here, this is the nozzle from which the fibers will spin, and this is how it gets collected. So Professor Manu Prakash suggested that one can use this cheap, low-cost machine to use some polymers, okay, dissolve them, and you again pour them in this thing, okay, which is spinning, and you have this thing heated, and you can spin out polymer fibers, okay. So they demonstrated that thermocol, maybe, or any many other polymers can be spun into very fine fibers, you know, just a few microns, and you can use these fibers to make masks, for face masks, for example, in this COVID situation. They have shown that you can make face masks simply using this low-cost machine, which costs, you know, some 12,000-13,000 rupees. I found this price on Amazon. So I am just saying that if you apply your mind, if you think of the need, sometimes these great ideas can come, you know, which can be also very simple. It may not also require always very complex or, you know, or very expensive things. What the proposal of Professor Manu Prakash was that this can allow local manufacturing. So people can just start to make, put this machine, make these fibers and start to make the mask. Of course, there are other steps involved, which I have not listed here. And related to this, I'm showing you something which we did in our lab using similar machine, but we made our own. This picture is of ceramic fibers now. And these fibers are between 10 to 15 micron. And you can see all the grain structure. Okay, these white spots that you're seeing are all zirconia, and the gray part is all alumina. And these fibers are for high temperature thermal insulation applications. So we did a lot of work. I had a PhD student, and there is a lot of market for this. Nobody in India is making these high temperature fibers. And these are the applications. You can make a lot of insulation products out of this. And you can make very good furnaces, which are rapid heating, cooling, you know, all these insulation boards you can make. But first you have to make fibers, then you have to compact these fibers to make these boards. And then, so we initially make the sol, okay, some chemical process. We use aluminum nitrate as the precursor. We make the sol, okay, and then we spin the sol as it was shown in that machine, okay. And then we look at, we do things like these. We look at viscosity and we decide, okay, after a certain viscosity, this sol becomes spinnable. If the viscosity is low, it does not form fiber. It just forms, you know, beads, okay. So like that. So you can see that, see here, if the viscosity is correct and then I pour the sol in this and it forms these fibers. So in appearance, it looks like candy floss, or it looks like that polymer fiber, but these are high temperature fibers and they can go up to 1700-1800 degrees C. Okay, that's the application. And see, so we figured out what viscosity and what RPM ranges will give us the best kind of fiber product. Okay, now this, we have done a lot, and we have the reason we added zirconia, as I told, was to limit the grain growth, because this is going to be used at high temperatures. So now we are trying to see how we can commercialize it. There are some aircraft engine applications also, and some people have been, you know, contacting us for that. Okay. This is another area I'm just quickly sharing. This is called gel casting of alumina. So ceramic slurries are used here, and we add some organic binders. And we produce these slurries and finally, you know, cast them, okay, and this monomer polymerizes and we form a shape, and then, you know, you can make some application out of it. So this is just showing you that we measure the viscosity of the slurries, we optimize some dispersing agents so that we get the minimum in viscosity. But after all, doing all this, we were able to show through our research that you can make a lot of different shapes out of this gel casting process, because you have a slurry and you cast it into a mold. So whatever is the shape of the mold, you can make that shape. And based on this knowledge, some of my students started a company. Okay. And this is some more work, but they started a company, and these are some old pictures from that company. It's called Ant Ceramics, that company. So they make a lot of ceramic components. And 2 years back, they for their work, they got award from the president also. For indigenous product development, and they are continuing to do newer and newer things. So you can see here the connection, you know, research from lab, some knowledge from the lab. Then initially they started very small, they struggled a lot, they started in 2006-07, and then finally they were able to use their knowledge. This is an unrelated picture, but I'm showing you now, because the same company and ceramics, you know, right now ceramic demand is not there because of all this COVID situation. What they have done is they have taken a technology from IIT Bombay for face mask. And the IIT Bombay technology basically is some natural biopolymers, and this kills the virus. Okay, so they have coated this mask with a coating which will kill the virus. So this is like an antiviral face mask. And this production they have just recently started. and it is available also from their website, the antiviral face mask. But why I'm showing you this is they quickly, because they are all educated in technology, they've studied here, okay? And they are very, very capable. This is very important. They are very capable with their experience to absorb any technology quickly. If they were new, they would not have been able to do it. Now they have experience, so they quickly absorb the technology and they are already producing these antiviral face masks, these gloves, these handkerchiefs and all that. Okay, now I'm going to show you this and maybe I'll do this more quickly. This is another product which we are working on in our lab. In the solar panels, all these line grid lines that you see is made of silver paste. This is a product which is used in India in huge quantities, but unfortunately, no Indian player is involved. This is made by companies which are very large, billion-dollar companies kind of. So it's very challenging, but we have a center here which has a pilot plant and we are trying to collaborate within IIT Bombay to develop this product. Okay, so we do everything in-house. We make our own silver powders by a chemical route. And the silver paste has silver powders, some glass powders and some organics. So we make this powders here, the glass, the silver powder in our lab. And then we do some high shear mixing and we have been making these pastes in our lab. These are our cells which are prepared in IIT Bombay by printing these silver pastes. Okay. And we have also come up with some other ideas from these silver based products. So we are trying to make some silver nano powders. They are very useful. They are antibacterial in nature. We are making some silver nanowires and then we have made some pastes which are used to print on polymer. And these printed patterns are used in all computer keyboards and all custom keyboards. When you press a key, basically you are connecting it. Actually, this is the real picture. When you press a key, you are actually connecting some dots or you're completing the circuit between two polymer membranes, which has silver. So we are trying to develop the silver paste also for that product. And we are trying to develop a pen, silver pen with silver ink, basically, not silver pen, but ink which has silver particles to make circuits on paper. So all of this thing we are trying to do now. Another example where we worked on porous ceramics from slurries and we added some binders and we made them by foaming them, we made these. So these are pictures of these porous ceramics, for example, you can see. Okay. And we used Rita. The soap nut, or in Hindi, it's called Rita. We extracted some surfactants from that. And we again made some porous ceramics. All work done by my PhD students. Very nice porous ceramics. And finally, I mean, I'll show you one or two more pictures. See, these porous ceramics resemble our bone structure also. The other application is it can give us a very good thermal insulation. One phase 1200 degrees, the other phase is only 160 degrees. And we also use some raw, waste material, for example, fly ash from burning coal for making some of these ceramic, porous ceramics. And very recently, we have made a machine. Again, needs a lot of input from mechanical and chemical engineers. We made this machine to make these foams continuously. And I'm still looking for, some more improvement in this machine. It is not yet perfected. And now some more maybe opportunities quickly, or maybe I'll skip this because I think I've taken too much time. I'll go to some, these are basically continuous flow reactors, which mechanical engineers can also contribute to. This is one interesting example, maybe I'll show you. This is some work from IIT Bombay, Professor Sanjay Mahajani of Tata Center. So what they did was they studied this jaggery making process. Like I was telling you, that when you want to help or develop products for somebody, you must go and meet these people. So what these pictures are from their visits. And Professor Mahajani's group, they surveyed some 400 units. I was really impressed to see this. They surveyed 400 units. They understood their problems, challenges, how labor intensive it is. Everything is manual, okay, and no otherwise quality control or monitoring, okay. So all these were disadvantages. So they surveyed 400 units to define their problem correctly. And finally, I'm showing you in the next slide their output. So one PhD...
Your slides are not visible.
Is it? Can you see this slide or no? Now I'm at...
Only your face is visible.
My face is visible, no slide. Hello?
Slide is visible, sir, visible.
Visible, no? Okay. Oh, I'm not... So I think no problem at my end. If some of you can see, then I think there is no problem at this end. So you are able to see this jaggery pictures, right?
No, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so, I don't know, maybe it's problem with some people at their end. So, of course, I can share the presentation later if some of you are missing it. But I'm showing in the next slide the output from IIT Bombay. See, what they've done by studying all this and through several PhD and master students and a lot of effort, they have built an automated plant. This is the picture of the plant and these are the, you know, some more pictures and this is the detail you can see. See how beautifully now no manual intervention, one person can run the entire plant. Okay. And of course, they have done all the chemistry study, the mechanical engineering, the automation, and you can see how the jaggery is getting cast. Okay. And pH measurement, temperature measurement, everything is sort of, you know, being done through sensors. So that's what I was saying. If you do a good talking to stakeholders, you survey all these things, then you understand the problem correctly, and then you can design the solution. Okay. This is one quick example and then I'll end. You know, this is an example from my students. It's not so much research, but some of my students, undergraduate students, okay, this is not a research project. I told them to make something useful out of milk bags. So these are the pictures, you know, they are taking milk bags, cutting, they are welding it by some hot gun, and I'll show you what they did. So they made this, they made these containers out of those milk bags. You see, I was telling them that, can you make containers in which I can make put some plants? So they have made these containers by using like a mandrel. And they also made this raincoat, you know, very nice raincoat. And they tested in their hostel shower. So this is just an example, okay, of trying to, you know, some solve some problem locally if you have to recycle milk bags, maybe creatively. But anyway, this is not a serious research project. But this also helped the undergraduates to become very enthusiastic. You know, they were suddenly very excited about all of these things. That is why I wanted to show you this picture. Okay. So this is my last part. If you allow me to present, only some 5-6 slides. And the reason I want to present is that
yes, sir.
All of... Sorry? Okay, right?
Okay,
sir. Yes, sir.
So,
yes.
Yeah, so after saying all of this, you know, I have said a lot of things to you, you know, product development, innovation, how it can improve our economy and how we should identify problem statement, right? And some opportunities. Now, sometimes many of us will also say that I am not as inspired, okay? Everything is there, but how do I keep my inspiration going every day? Or how do I become, for example, Vikram Sarabhai, you know, and we have to believe that each of us can become either Vikram Sarabhai or Homi Bhabha or Varghese Kurian, because if we don't believe, we'll not become, right? But how to be inspired? So I'm giving some thoughts that my thoughts that I'm just sharing. Okay. How to find endless inspiration so that you always remain inspired. I hope you can connect with this. So what I'm trying to show in this picture is, you know, this picture is of money, but I'm not saying that money is the inspiration. This is just for only I've taken for fun. But basically what I'm trying to say is I want to quickly give you one small hypothetical example, and particularly to the young students who are in the seminar, that imagine if I were to give you, when you were born, if I give you 29,200 rupees the day you are born, okay? But there is one condition. I think it can be probably nice. Somebody is giving 29,200 rupees in your bank account just when you are born in your name. But I will put one condition that I will not allow you to work throughout your life, and your bank interest can, I mean, your bank deposit cannot earn interest. So what I am trying to say is I have given you 29,200 rupees for your whole life. Okay. And if you are willing to accept, then take it. But you cannot work for money. You can work, but you cannot earn any money and you cannot earn any interest. So whenever I tell this story to anybody, they say, no, sir, it is not possible. How can I live my whole life in 29,200 rupees? Okay, it's very small sum. So then I say that this is why I said this story is this is just an example. I mean, this is just an imaginary situation. It is not real, but in another way, it is real. I made one assumption that all of us will live for about 80 years, okay? And I think that's a reasonable assumption, maybe little more, sometimes little less. But average 80 years if we live, and I multiplied 80 by 365, because 1 year is 365 days, right? So the number I get, 80 into 365 is 29,200. So now the real story is we don't have 29,200 rupees, but we have 29,200 days when we are born, approximately. And every day we are spending 1 rupee, which means every day we are spending one day, right? And now you can imagine we cannot add bank interest. Like I cannot increase this 29,200 days to suddenly 50,000 days, because I cannot live for for example, 140 years or something, right? So what I'm trying to say is time is limited. The message is that, and I always feel this 29,200 days is very short. Imagine those of you who are 20-year-old students, if I ask you where you will become one day 50-year-old, none of you can imagine easily that I will become 50-year-old. But from when you are 20-year-old, when all of us who are faculty now, who are in colleges and were 20-year-old, from 20-year-old to becoming 50-year-old, it only takes 11,000 days. Okay, in 11,000 days, you become from 20-year-old to 50-year-old. So my message is, time is very important. Please value every day. Okay. And this, I feel, you know, whenever I think of it, that life is short, life is limited, I have to do many things, I feel very inspired. Every day I feel inspired then. Okay, if I think, oh, there is too much time, all that, then maybe I will take it very easy. But, you know, life is not very, very, you know, it is a short life. Then some facts may be more applicable to students, but some of them applicable to all of us. It's very important to realize that when we come to this world, when we are born, we have no possessions, right? We bring no money, no property, nothing. And when we leave this world, when we die, we will not take anything from here. Why I say this in this forum is, see, we are talking of product, innovation, and all of this also, if we want to become an entrepreneur, it involves a lot of risk also, right? What I'm trying to say is, since I didn't bring anything in this world and I cannot take anything back, so we should not worry so much. We should not worry about also taking risks. We should take some risks, because if we don't take risk, we cannot gain anything, right? So we should not get worried. We should not worry if I'm not getting more money, less money, this, that, you know, we should become not so insecure, okay? Because there is nothing to lose. I didn't bring anything to this world. Also, materialistic comforts, okay? If we just go after a lot of money, it will not bring intellectual challenges. And all of us are here, researchers, scientists, engineers, okay, we always look for intellectual challenges. So it's very important to think what I want. Do I want intellectual challenges? Or if somebody says, no, you stay inside one house for all your life, I will give you, you know, few crore rupees. I think none of us will like it. Okay, and our experience in COVID also may be realizing sitting at home can be quite challenging. Okay, then another thing, our search for security in life can never end. So security in our lives cannot come from outside. Okay, if we think of this first fact, okay, we can always feel secure. We need not worry. Okay, and very important that we should stay happy and always we should try to do what we really love to do. Okay, because right, basically, oh, I'll get much bigger salary here. Okay, but you will spend a lot of time also. What is more valuable, time or money? Money you can always get, but time you cannot ever get back. So it's very important to do what you really love to do. That will make you happy. And that way you will not regret your time has gone. The other thing is, if you are really happy, you made the right choice, then you will be most creative. You will be very confident and you will make some good contributions. The other thing that I always say to people is that, I know it is not a very easy statement, but I always tell everybody, and I think that is because I say, you know, if you want to be inspired all your life, you want to be creative all your life somehow, you know, as long as you have your body parts are working, you should try to find a purpose of your life. If you don't have a purpose in your life, no, then you will get deviated. If you don't have a purpose, you will always look for money. Are kitna salary aa raha hai? When will I get promotion? Okay. Why am I not getting that much? Why other person is earning more? All this will happen. Or why can't I buy that expensive car? All that will happen when I don't have a purpose in life. Once I find a purpose, then I am satisfied and I will try to do many things to satisfy or fulfill that purpose. Okay. And I've taken an example from mechanical engineering, for example. You can imagine if I were to take any of you and if I leave you in a very good workshop, I say, oh, here is a very good mechanical engineering workshop. Okay. Every tool is available, but suppose you did not think what I have to make, the tools are of no use. Similarly, money, everything is of no use if we have not decided our purpose of life. Or the Japanese people call it ikigai, which is an overlap of all these things. What you love to do, what the world needs, what you can be paid for and what you are good at. If you can find this overlap, that is almost like finding the purpose of your life, which is also called the ikigai. Once you have a purpose in your life, you will have enough reasons to wake up in the morning. You will not feel that being lazy. You will always feel inspired. Okay, I want to go and do something. Okay. And I always feel that sooner you find it, the better it is, particularly for younger people and for anybody else. And once you find a purpose in your life, you know, all these things happen to you. You are all, you know, generally more cheerful. Even if you get some lows in your life, you come out of it very easily. You don't run out of energy. Generally, you won't feel, you know, and you don't feel bored. You will always want to do something. You find this world beautiful because you have a purpose. You want to achieve something. And almost everything starts to appear connected in your life. Okay. And this is the last message, I think, or maybe second last message. Some Nobel Prize winners say that it's very important to focus in life. You should not get interested in everything. You should decide, focus, so that you become very effective. You should decide what you should not work on. Okay. And this is lastly few points for applied research. But I think maybe I can, or maybe I can quickly say that, you know, it's very important when you do applied research to keep some application and products in mind from early on. You should always think of how you will scale up these things. Okay. As I said, stay focused. You should meet a lot of people, visit a lot of industries, go to industrial exhibitions, interact with people who are, you know, looking for some problem solving. For the faculty, I would say that you should, they should encourage students to think in their in entrepreneurial mode and remain associated with professional societies. I think that was my last slide. I will end here. I know I've taken a lot of time. I'm sorry for taking much more time, but I thought I'll share some of these thoughts. So I can answer questions if there are any. I'll try to stop sharing now.
Thank you, sir. Hello?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. It is a wonderful session, sir. Sir, I have a query from the chat box. Arjit Basu, he asked one question. Sir, the Pesmark, the face mask, your research group prepared so for how many time period does it combat with the COVID virus? Like, what is the stability of the face mask?
So the complete virus, meaning 100% virus killing, right, takes about 1 hour. But I think if you have lower concentration, it would take a fewer minutes, okay? So the main thing here is the advantage is that normally, you know, we will come from outside our house and we will put it at different places, right? So if you just leave it at some place in this mask, in other masks, the virus may not kill fast, but in this mask, the virus will kill itself quickly. Basically, even if you touch by hand later on in the front, it is no problem because virus has been killed. And a lot of testing has already been done. If you go to their website, no, you will see that they have uploaded a certificate of testing. This product was developed at IIT Bombay. They have they are scaling it up and commercializing.
So how you are going to validate this, sir?
Validate what, sorry?
So how it kills, sir?
Oh, how the mechanism, I am not entirely sure because this is not our technology, but they have done testing by both for coronavirus swabs. They have done the technology is from Professor Rinti Banerjee of Bioscience IIT Bombay, but our students' company has commercialized it. Professor Rinti Banerjee has done these tests, and later on, after production started, that this company also has done a test in a company in Mumbai for bacteria and viruses.
Sir, this virus is this mask which you have prepared. So this is reusable or
20 up to 20 to 30 times you can wash, and it remains antiviral. They have tested it. Basically, the washing is not required because of virus. If the mask is getting dirty, so you don't necessarily have to wash.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So, sir, I have another question. Is there, sir? What is the cost of it?
The cost of this mask is, I think, around 149 rupees. But for bulk purchases, they give some discount.
Okay.
But retail, if one piece is 149 rupees. That is what I know.
Thank you, sir.
The somebody is asking the website detail. If you type ants duraprot, D-U-R-A-P-R-O-T, or even if you go to antslab.com, I think, or antslab.co.in, I'm not very sure. But if you just search ants, A-N-T-S, Duraprot, you will get the link of the website.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Anything else? And I just request people to... and I can, I mean, later on share the result with the organizers if you like.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Sir, one question. Sir, completing first year, how to start innovation?
See, if you listened carefully, the most important thing in my experience of 2020, so you have to identify a good problem or a need or a requirement, and what you can do that, you have to seriously meet some potential customers. Suppose you want to develop a product for household. So maybe if you meet a lot of different mothers, suppose you want to develop a product for kitchen, something improvement. So you have to meet a lot of different mothers or father, whoever is using the kitchen. And then, or if you want to develop product for farmers, meet at least 100 farmers and do a survey of their needs. Once you do that, then only you can start thinking of innovation. Without the problem, you cannot, you know, think of innovation.
Sir, can you share the slide?
I can share the slides with the organizers, and then they can share with the, you know, with the
feedback room, sir.
Sorry?
Feedback. Sir, they are asking for feedback. We will provide you. Don't worry. At 1 p.m. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Parag, sir.
Sure.
Sir, one more question is that
I would like.
What is the? They were asking that you said that means problem I have to start the. So according to which problem should I start first?
See, I would always suggest that you should work on some local issues. Okay, initially when you start, and you should always start simple, right? You cannot do. I don't think, as somebody said in the chat also, Mr. Gurulingam, I think that we need not go to some high-tech research. We need not do nanotechnology only or robotics only. I mean, we should start something simple, which the people need, which the customers need. Imagine wherever you are living, the biggest town, if you can do some survey with the industry or with the shopkeeper or whatever is the local. For example, I think Kalahandi produces a lot of rice. And the rice husk has a lot of uses. Can you develop some new application of rice husk, for example? Or Kalahandi district, I think, has a lot of bauxite. Bauxite is usable to make some grinding wheel. You can make a material for grinding wheel. You know, it's a very hard material once you fire it. So you should try to base it on a local problem or a local need. Okay. That is most important. But like I said, always you have to, or maybe you can solve some problem. You can do some survey within your college. Maybe you can do some improvement within the college, for example. Okay, suppose in college you are using some certain material which can be recycled. Can you solve the problem of recycling in the college? Okay, so start small first. Something small. Don't think of high tech. Don't think of something very big initially. Slowly as you gain experience, you can do bigger things. Okay.
Sir, like agriculture waste management, like that.
Agriculture has many opportunities. Many engineers think that maybe there is nothing, but agriculture has many opportunities. But you have to get the problem from the farmer. But you should not think. That is what my main message was.
Who is facing problem? We have to take feedback.
Yeah, you have to. That's right. You have to take feedback from those who are facing problem. You don't decide the problem. Then you will always give the wrong solution. Because your problem may be wrong. So you go to farmers, meet 100 farmers, write down, make notes, take pictures, you know, take video, whatever, come back to your college, talk to your professors and start doing things. Okay?
Sir, means also in Smart India Hackathon, many problem statements are there. But
Sorry?
But they're a little complicated.
You don't worry about those things. First, you should start small, start local, and slowly as you get experience, then you will understand this process of innovation.
Yes, sir. By talking to Sinesh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So, we'll move to the second session. The second session will be given by Dr. Chinmay Kaur, sir. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of GC Kalahandi. Sir, please, sir, Chinmay, sir.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Tripathi sir, Principal Professor Dolu Patnaik sir, HOD Mechanical Professor Mrityunjay Raut sir, Conveners Professor Bagal and Professor Ajit Patnaik, and my friend Professor L.P. Panda, the co-speaker Professor Bhargav, and all dear HODs, faculty members, and my dear student friends. Whoever is here, thank you very much for inviting me for this webinar. As you know, we have already seen that how the innovation happens for product manufacturing. I will mainly dwell upon another project that is called manufacturing sustainability. Just now I saw that one question was there on Industry 4.0. Rather, let me tell you that Industry 4.0 starts from this manufacturing sustainability. And this reliability analysis that I would like to discuss today, that is best practices of reliability analysis in industries. And I will cite some case studies. Now, the Industry 4 actually uses this type of case studies and automate the decision making. And that's the reason the main problem is that we solve the industrial problems. Okay, just now I gave one particular, is my presentation visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible.
So this is the proverb that machine speaks and it pays to listen. And what is the benefit that gives? Hello?
Presentation is not visible.
Oh. Sir, your screen is visible, but presentation is not visible, sir.
Is it not visible?
No.
Just let me share again.
Yeah, please do it.
Is it visible now?
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Fine. Fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. So the topic of this discussion is best practices of reliability analysis in industries. And we'll discuss some case studies. And as I was telling about one proverb, that these machines, you see, these are the machines, steam turbine, compressors, these actually speaks. And it will benefit to the mankind if at all we'll listen to them. And how we'll listen to them? By doing different reliability analysis. And if we automate this reliability analysis, then we'll come to the Industry 4.0. That we don't need experts at a later stage, because already we have automated their thought process. And with this context, already Professor Bhargav has given me a good introduction, so I don't need to speak about my introduction. And the theme of this particular webinar is sustainable manufacturing. And this sustainable manufacturing is now the most important problem of these industries. And I'll relate to my topic, that is reliability. How the sustainable manufacturing is related to reliability. Now, there are three pillars of sustainable manufacturing. One is social. This pillar or factor focus on corporate social responsibility or CSR. So the company has to spend something to get the goodwill of the people or the employees. So in that sense, they have to spend some amount and get a social recognition in terms of brand encouragement. They will generate employment, they will develop the skills. So these are all different social factors of sustainable manufacturing. The second part, the second pillar is environmental sustainability or environmental pillar factors. So here we should have a least environmental emission, least material wastage, least water contamination and consumption. So there should not be any wastage of chemical, toxic chemicals. So these are all environmental factors of the sustainable manufacturing. The third factor is economic, that a manufacturing sector cannot strive if at all they cannot make profit. So making profit is the sole aim. It may not be the sole aim because there are other factors like social and environmental factors, but still it is the main benefit of the manufacturing sectors. So in this sense, we have to optimize the maintenance cost. We have to have highest efficiency in the production. We should have the best productivity in the manufacturing. So the most important point is that a reliable plant can achieve sustainable manufacturing. Because a reliable, how this is connected, that I'll speak in the next slide, that how the reliability affects sustainability. So before that, I'd like to define what is reliability. So reliability is nothing but the probability that a machine or plant performs its intended function for a certain time period and a specified operating environment. So a particular machine should perform up to, let us assume, 3 years without failure. Then this is called a reliable machine. Similarly, it should operate under some certain operating environment, some temperature. In summer season, the temperature goes up. So it should be able to sustain that amount of temperature, environmental temperature. I have given an example. Let us consider this is a pump. This is a tank one from where the fluid will be given to tank two through this pump. So this pump has a function that it delivers 100 liter per minute. At 5 bar pressure. Let us assume. And then how this function will not be able to mate. There are two types of cases. Like reliability is affected by leakages in pumps, tanks or pipeline. Failure in pumps or component. And these leakages will create environmental problems. Similarly, failure in pump will create a lot of manufacturing cost, maintenance cost. So this will affect the economic sustainability. So this particular aspect that now we can see how the reliability of a plant or machine is connected to the sustainability factors. So environmental sustainability and economic sustainability of a plant sustainability. So this is all about how reliability is connected to the sustainability. Now, how this reliability is affected? So there are different factors because of which the reliability of a machine or plant is affected. These are first design issues. As our Professor Bhargav told, that the design is a very important part of any particular sustainable operation. So sometimes the machine that they have fitted is out of specification. There are lack of standby machines. So when one machine fails, the standby machine cannot take over. So this is the reason that reliability is affected. So there are some operation issues. The operator have operated the plant out of the design range or out of the mentioned range by the OEM, or original equipment manufacturer. Lack of monitoring and control by different people. So it will create some reliability issues, and ultimately it will create sustainability issues. Then maintenance issues, lack of preventive maintenance, lack of procedures. So these will also affect the reliability. Then competency issues, lack of skills, lack of training. So this will create a problem in the reliability of the plant. So my talk will be mostly discussing 4 case studies pertaining to these reliability problems. So I will discuss 4 case study. One is a design and operation issues, and I will give an example of a boiler feed water pump, high vibration. I will also discuss another case study, design and maintenance issues, where I have solved some very important problem of cooling water fan reliability enhancement. And then my case study 3 will be discussing about how to do bad actor management in the plant. And my case study 4 will tell how to diagnose problems so that we can plan our maintenance properly. And all these are very technical in nature. So I'll see that, and this is also very cross-sectional. You can tell lot of different departments can learn from these issues, and lot of different problems are being covered by different techniques of interdisciplinary techniques like signal processing in electronics, artificial intelligence in computer. So decision support system in computer or computer science. So all these things can be applied in this type of reliability studies. So this is the case study 1. This is a boiler feed water pump, high vibration. Let me tell you where this boiler feed water pump is being used. This is being used before the boilers. Other ammonia plant, fertilizer plants. So before the boiler, the pump, the water has to be at a very high pressure. It has to be delivered at very high pressure. And this, so you can imagine that this particular BFW pump has a specification of 4.45 megawatt. So you can see that how much megawatt power it is required. So the capacity of this BFW pump is very high. And this, there are some specification I have given. What are the different specification? You can see the specific discharge pressure. The discharge pressure is 137 kg force per cm square G, which is very, very high. So this boilers has a different specification as well as different rating. For example, this is pump rated speed is 3555 RPM. So this is the specification. What we are facing, very high vibration for this pump. And I will discuss how we resolve this high vibration. So I went through all the data. Yes. Yes. Anything you want? Hello.
Please continue.
Yes. So there are different data. I can see you, show you that pump personal natural frequency and pump natural frequency, lateral natural frequency. Those who are studying mechanical vibration currently or are going to study later, you should know that this natural frequency is a very important design parameters. Whenever the speed will be near to this natural frequency, the vibration will be very high. So we should, first of all, our attention should go to this natural frequency. And when I saw this data, the first thing is I saw that one particular natural frequency, that is personal natural frequency, is very near to the pump rated speed. It is around 10%. So which is very near. Actually, rated speed, it actually operates much below the rated speed. So whenever the speed will be near to this, the vibration will be higher. So then this is the first impact that I can see from the design data. So this is the vibration. The vibration is generally measured in velocity, RMS velocity. Then we can see that the vibration is gradually increased in 2010 to 2013. There are a lot of maintenance that has been done on this machine. So maintenance cost was very huge. And then gradually it remains stable after one maintenance. And again, the vibration increased. There are a lot of other maintenance has been done, but still the vibration didn't decrease. So this was a headache of the operation as well as maintenance, that why the vibration is not decreasing. At this point of time, actually, I took this analysis and then analyzed this particular issue. So I actually went through the shaft vibration analysis. I think you will read this shaft, how to measure shaft vibration in your fourth year. Some may be reading in mechanical vibration subject. The faculty may be knowing that this vibration, shaft vibration, is collected from different points. So these are the different points of the machine. So this is the pump, this is the turbine, this is the gearbox, this is the turbine. So different points we collect the vibration, and we can see that some diagnostics we have done, that very large noise floor, this is one issue. And then there are dominant 1x amplitude. 1x means the rotating speed. The rotating speed is being determined. And then we find there are large vibration at the rotating speed. We did the, so this is shaft vibration analysis, and we also did the casing vibration analysis. So this is the severity analysis with different standard. You can see this is the shaft vibration analysis, which is very normal. So C grade is very, very normal. But if you see the casing vibration is very, very high. This is A category, means it is very high vibration. So different standard, we compared this vibration, and then we found that the casing vibration is very high. And one important point that I discussed earlier, that the speed I found is 3,235 RPM, which is just very less than rated speed, but which is very near to the 1.6% greater than the first critical speed mode, personal critical speed mode. And also, this is the Campbell diagram. This Campbell diagram you may be reading during your design stages. In the design stages, you can see that this is the speed you increased, and these are the natural frequency, different natural frequency. So at this particular 3,235 RPM, this actually intersects with the natural frequencies. The speed intersects with the natural frequency. At the sixth time and seventh time of the speed also, this actually intersects with the natural frequency. And there is also API670, which is telling that there should be difference between the torsional speed, torsional critical speed, and the speed, actually operating speed of the pump. This would be around 10%. So the diagnosis is that the operating, this particular machine is operating very near to the torsional critical speed. And this is the diagnostics, so which is not advisable. So I gave different type of, for example, I told that increase the speed, and there was a lot of resistance to do that, because people were telling that when we increase speed, generally vibration increases. So I gave some advisory to them that if vibration increase, will increase the speed in the field, and if vibration increases, then it will be rotor unbalance. So we can do overhauling of the pump. We'll do the complete maintenance of the pump. You can remove this particular issue. If vibration decreases, then it is actually equal to the torsional critical speed effect. That means our diagnosis is correct. And then we should go after removing this, we should increase the speed. If vibration decreases and then increases, it is both torsional critical speed and rotor unbalance effect. Otherwise, if vibration remains constant with increase in speed, there'll be structural rigidity effect. So these are the four different scenario we gave. And then we did a field test. We went to the field, we increased the speed gradually from 3,235 RPM to 3,500 RPM. You can see we have increased the speed, gradually the vibration increased. And this was the operating speed where the vibration was very large. Gradually the speed increased and we got a very large speed here, a very large vibration, 9.8. But then when we increase the speed, okay, the vibration decreased. And it was the lowest at this speed of 3,420 RPM. So this was the field test done in the plant. And then we confirmed that actually this is the operating speed where there a lot of vibration was there. So this is a torsional, this is under the torsional critical speed effect. So if at all we'll increase the speed, definitely this particular vibration will decrease. So what we did, we got the result now. We actually changed the procedure and we operated the speed, operated the pump around 3,400 RPM. We decreased the vibration around 90 to 30%. And then you can see how the speed, this vibration decreased. So this is one of the case study. And remember, we can very well automate this, that we can feed in our computer algorithm that how this speed, what is the speed and what is the torsional critical speed. This Campbell diagram, we can do automate, we can automate this, and then we can know if at all we are operating in the safe margin or not. So if not, then we have to change the speed. So this was a very successful reliability analysis. This was my first reliability analysis in that company. And then let me discuss another case study, which is cooling tower fan reliability enhancement. So what is the function of this cooling tower? You can see this cooling tower. This is a very huge cooling tower. The height is 51 meter. The base diameter is 70 meter. And you see the fans. The fans are very high, very large size. This is of 6.7 meter diameter, this ring. And inside this ring, there are fans. Okay, so this is the cooling tower. What cooling tower does? Cooling tower cools the water coming from different heat exchangers of the plant. So if the heat exchanger temperature is very large, then definitely water cooling water temperature is large, then efficiency of the heat exchanger decreases. So whenever this cooling tower cools the liquid, it requires the air given by the fan. So the fan reliability is very bad, then it cannot cool the cooling water to a certain temperature. So efficiency of the plant will be very bad. So it will not be economically sustainable in the plant. So that's the reason this is a very important, cooling tower fans are very important to the plant. This is the just design of this cooling tower, you can see. This very important point is that this makes an angle to the horizontal. So this is a big fan of 6.7 meter, you can see. The 6.7 is the 7 is the diameter of the blade of this fan. And then it actually have an inclination of 5 degrees. and there are 24 fans all around these. So this you can see, there are six fans in this side. In the back side, there are six fans. In the left-hand side and right-hand side, there are six fans each. So there are 25 fans. So there are different sections. So we can see here only one section. So this is the cooling tower, and this fan has a lot of reliability problem. Just before that, I would like to discuss what are the components of this fan. This fan is, this is the axis of the fan, and this is the blade. The blade length will be around 1.5 meter or 1.7 meter. These are the U-bolt. And these U-bolts are made of steel. So generally they corroded. And there are also, there are half and returning bolts. So what is the problem? The problem is that there are a lot of failures that happened in this. There are a lot of problems in the U-bolt and clamp. You can see U-bolt and clamps, 28% of the failure happened. Gearbox, 18% of the failure. Then the blades are 19% of the failure. So this is the problem that we're facing. These cooling tower fans have a lot of problems. There are always, there will be something will be failing, which will reduce the efficiency of the plant. So then we took this project, and this project objective was this, that analyze all the failure modes in details so as to mitigate the root cause of the failures, investigate the design and changes in the design if required, apply preventive maintenance measures so as to improve the life of the component, thus enhancing the reliability of the cooling tower fans. Then analyze the effects of the above changes. Are we successful in increasing the reliability of the plant? So this is our main objectives. So this is a typical fault tree analysis. This fault tree analysis is like, you have to ask five whys, that why the cooling tower fan reliability problem, why there is a downtime or reliability problem of cooling tower fan. We found one problem, that is blade failure. Why the blade failure happens? The mistakes in installation of the blades. Why there is a mistakes in installation of blade? Because there is no measurement accuracy. There's a lack of expertise. Why there is no measurement accuracy? Unavailability of state of art measurement system. So these are different problems. And here, another important problem we found, that there is a rubbing with the ring. This is actually we have observed in the cooling tower fan. And this, there is a, what is the reason? What may be the reason? Maybe there is a blade and shaft unbalance. There is a U-bolt looseness. And why this looseness will come? Because there is resonance. Okay, foundation looseness. Because of this, there may be some problem. So like this, unbalance. Why there will be blade unbalance? That there is a salt deposits in the blade, because this particular plant is situated very near to the seashore. So that's the reason in the blade, there are salt deposits, which will actually make unbalance of the shaft. Falling of the earlier corrective weights. In the blade, there are some corrective weights given to balance, but that has fall down because of the corrosion. So this is the type of fault tree analysis we have done so as to find out the root causes. So we took two action plans. First of all, we wanted to change the design of the blade. The blades were very heavy. We want to make it lighter. The U-bolts were steel, so they were corroding. So there is a corrosion. So we want to make it different material, duplex type of material. So we wanted to change the design. The second part we revised the PM plan, the preventive maintenance plan. How to maintain this type of U-bolt, how to maintain the blades. So these are the different things that we worked out. So in the case of design case, as you know, already Professor Bhargav has told, the design is very important part of our manufacturing sustainability. It should be properly designed. Earlier, you see, these are the different components. The blades were very heavy. So in one particular design, we actually decreased the blade by changing the material of the blade. We told the OEM to change the material of the blade. Then we also changed the U-bolt and knots and washers material. This is, we moved to duplex. So it is slightly corrosion free. We also did another fan, which is very, very heavy. So this is very light and this is very heavy. But this heavy, why? What we thought? We thought that this will be very rugged, okay, very sturdy. So there will be no failure. So we tested for near about 2 years, 3 years for this type of case. We also changed the preventive maintenance plan. Like earlier, we are not doing any visual inspection. Now every 15 days we'll do regular visual inspection, whether there is a salt deposit or not. We'll do 1 month PM plan. Well, the blade has to be cleaned every month. The blade angle has to be checked. You know, the blade, because the angle is there, there are lot of unbalance. So that's the reason we have to recheck the angle. Integrity checking of U-bolts, if there is a looseness in the U-bolts or not. So all these things, then retorquing of the U-bolts. If there is a looseness, every three months will be retorqued. And this is very important. This 1 year plan, we have to replace the U-bolts and clamps every 1 year. So this cost is very minimal in terms of cost, but actually the efficiency improvement is very high. So we thought that there will not be, it will be very economical to the whole plant, if at all you replace the U-bolt and clamps. And we have done different analysis, the reliability analysis, like mean time between failure, the reliability growth analysis to find these aspects. Then we did this for so many days. Let us consider here 763 days. So around 2 years, we have see that the fan L, that is the lower, the duplex U-bolt, we have used that and we found that operation time is very high. Availability of the fan is very high. Maintenance time is very less. Okay. And there was only one failure in 2 years, this 763 days. So the MTBF is very, very high. In case of fan H, it failed and then it could not be rectified. So the operation time is very less. Availability is very less. Maintenance time is very high. And cost is even 14 times. So that's the reason we actually rejected this design. So failure of two fans have been reduced. So these fans, why we selected earlier? These fans were causing very large vibration or reliability issues earlier. Now the fans have very less failure. Only two failures in two years. So we have chosen this particular fan, that is the blade is lighter and the U-bolt is different material. So this is the case that earlier, you see, this was 43% of the failure. This is 32% only. So now the failure is gradually distributed all over. But how much reduction? Reduction is, you see, 56% of the reduction in the failure. So earlier, whatever failure numbers we have seen, around 300 or 400 in failures in 3 years. Now it is hardly 150, 160 failures, which is very less, which we can manage. Reduction in maintenance cost of this is around 41%. So $1 million has been saved because of this and new PM plan. Then reduction in notification, the failure notification has been decreased. So we have completely eliminated the blades failure and U-bolts failure. So this is another case study that we discussed. That is a cooling water fan problems, reliability issues. So we could actually, by changing the design and by changing the PM plan, to find a very good impact. Now, next case study that I will discuss, it is called bad actor management. You know, what are bad actors? Bad actors, nothing but the machines or assets with large maintenance cost for last 3 years duration. So there are some problem. You know, there is a Pareto chart which tells that 80% problems are because of 20% assets. So hardly very few assets, they cost a lot of maintenance cost. So what is our aim of this particular problem? First of all, identify these assets. So this is very important. So we have to identify the bad actors or assets which are causing reliability issues. The second case is resolve this bad actor. Resolution may be, as I told you earlier, the design change, the maintenance strategy change. Okay, so different things that we can do so as to resolve these bad actors. And then reduction in the maintenance cost. This is the most important part. So we did a workflow in which we have to identify what are the bad actors. So we didn't consider the preventive. There are three types of maintenance. You may be knowing in your mechanical, if at all you are mechanical fourth year, the three different types of maintenance scheme. One is the corrective maintenance, one is breakdown maintenance, another is preventive maintenance. Preventive maintenance is that when nothing is there, no problem is there, still we are doing the maintenance. But whenever there is a problem, we are doing maintenance, it is nothing but corrective and breakdown maintenance. So we choose this data only. Corrective and breakdown maintenance, not preventive maintenance, from the SAG. And we have automated this. It is not that we are taking individually all the data. No, we have automated that in the Meridium system. There is a software called Meridium. We have automated this algorithm. We calculated the cumulative maintenance cost for 3 years. And then we found whether this particular problem is repeating. And if the consequence is very high, like $100,000, then actually we'll consider our study. If at all not, then this is a privilege given to the management whether they want to study or not. But whenever it is $100,000, then we should definitely study and resolve the problem. So now I'll show you different analysis. So there are different type of equipment available in the machine, in the plant. Rotating type of equipment, static. Rotatings are nothing but pumps, compressors, turbines. Statics means not vessels, reactors. The electronics and instrumentation, these are motors, instruments, and all other data, like conveyors. So these are all other type of machines. And these are the maintenance cost. You see, 61% of the rotating equipment consumes some 69% of the maintenance cost, corrective and breakdown maintenance cost. Just to tell what is the total maintenance cost, just to give you an example, this total maintenance cost was around $24 million. So you can imagine how much we are spending per year, this much of money. And then the type of assets, what are the different types? 26% are pumps, and turbines are 10%. Compressor, these are huge capacity. I will discuss one compressor part in case study 4. And this is very huge capacity. There are 10% of the compressor, but these are of very high capacity. So these actually create a lot of problem. The shutdown of the plant, this 10%. Even this 10% also cause shutdown of the plant. Some pumps may not cause shutdown, but they cost a lot in maintenance costs. As I told you, one boiler feed water pump, that is huge pumps. And these pumps actually consume a lot of maintenance. So these are the different type of assets that we have come across in our bad actor analysis. So in the case of failure mode, so if at all we'll consider the rotating equipment, 61% of the rotating equipment, what are their different failure modes we have observed? You see, some bearings failure, this is very, very important failure. Always you'll see some bearing fails. So this is 22%. Thrust bearing fails, 6%. Mechanical seal damage, this is the another important mode of failure in this type of rotating equipment. 28% of the seals failed, and 7% gearbox failed, and 37% other failure. You may be thinking that why we need this analysis? We need this analysis because if the seals are failing, then we can contact the seal vendor to tell that why our seals are failing in all other components. So they can give us a very good design, new design, or they can give us solution. So this type of failure mode analysis are required. In case of bearings are failing, we can change the preventive maintenance. Let us consider every 3 years we'll replace the bearing. So this 22% will be decreasing. So like that, this failure mode analysis are very important for our case. And this other failure means impeller failures of the pumps, coupling failures, sensor failures in the pumps. So these are the different type of failure that we can go through. Sorry. So this is the bad actor failure mode analysis. This is a very important part in our analysis because here we can take decision that what type of action we should take. Okay. For example, bearing failure, as I told you, we'll change the maintenance replacement plan. So we'll take that every 3 years I'll replace the bearing so that the bearing will not fail in 4 years or 5 years time. We have to find out what is the mean time between failure of the bearing problem. So that after doing that, we can change the replace the bearing every 3 years or 2 years. Similarly, seals, every 3 years or 2 years, we have to replace the seals or we have to get a new design seals. So these are the different action that we have taken. And because of that, this is the result that in 2014-2016, 3 years time period, there are 88 number of failures. And this failure had decreased to 74. And this is not a small amount. The 74, the 14 numbers are not very small amount. I'll tell you in terms of dollar terms. The other results are, you see, 88 to 74, we have decreased. The bad actor, 16%. Bad actor maintenance, corrective maintenance cost, 35%. breakdown on corrective maintenance cost 14.5%. You can think that this is only 14.5%, but actually, in terms of dollar, it is around $8 million. So we have saved around $8 million out of $24 million. And this is the corrective breakdown and corrective maintenance cost. Total maintenance cost has been reduced. You can see the initially the total maintenance cost was $80 million and now around $56 million. We have reduced the total cost. And this is so you can see the efficiency of this type of analysis that near about $8 million we have saved in 2 years' time. And the number of notification, the headache to the, this is the headache, number of notification is large. The maintenance team actually used to go to the plant, go to the machine and do a lot of analysis. So that headache has been reduced by 11%. So this is our achievement in the case study three. Now let me discuss another case study. This is the last case study. So I'll give more time to the question answer session because I know there'll be a lot of question answer questions on this aspect. So this is my last case study. That this is a synthesis gas compressor, which is commissioned in 1986. So it is very old compressor. And this case study pertains to a problem that is ROG we have diagnosed before the maintenance. So we could plan the maintenance very well. So maintenance time was reduced. So here you can see this is the turbine, which is running two different compressor cases, LP, that is low pressure compressor, this is high pressure compressor. And you can see the capacity is 22.5 megawatt. You know the boiler feed water pump was up 4 megawatt capacity. It was huge, but now it is very, very high capacity, 22.5 megawatt capacity. So these compressors are very huge compressors. There you can see their pressure will be very, very high. The pressure outlet pressure will be some 200 bar. So this inlet steam temperature, you can see pressure 102 kg per cm square or 100 bar around. This particular steam turbine takes the steam. So you can imagine what is the compressor size, how important it is to the plant. So here you can see that, as I told you in BFW pump also, we measure shaft vibration at each shaft, two vibration at each shaft. So this is the one end of the LP cylinder. This is another end of the LP cylinder. This is called driving end. This is non-driving end. This is driving end because this is connected to the steam turbine driver. Similarly, this is LP end of the steam turbine. This is HP end of the steam turbine. We measure shaft vibration. This is micron, in terms of micron. Earlier in BFW pump, I had told you RMS value in meter per second square, and here it is micron. So this is the shaft vibration because of which this is displacement. So these are all different points we have taken, and you can see at certain points, there are 42 micron shaft speed, whereas some cases it is 13 micron. So this shaft vibration was very high at certain point. And here it was 53 micron. You can see at this end it is 11 micron, but here it is 53 micron. So because of this, there are a lot of vibration issue was there in this system. So what I was asked to find, what is the problem? Why this vibration is very high? So that they can plan the maintenance. So there's a turnaround maintenance, like every 3 years, they used to do this maintenance. So before the maintenance, if they know what is the problem this synthesis gas compressor is undergoing, then they can plan the maintenance. They can only replace those components. So the time of the maintenance will be very, very low. So that's the reason I was asked to do the diagnostics of this type of compressor and steam turbine system. So the objective was to provide diagnostics result of such large vibration of the steam turbine and HP compressor, which will initiate exact maintenance plan during the turnaround, that is 3 years maintenance cycle, resulting in faster maintenance. So this was the objective of this case study. The presentation that I will share will show you the experience of vibration analysis. So some people may be thinking, what is this vibration analysis? I'll tell you just one aspect, small aspect. If at all opportunity comes, then I can completely explain you what is a vibration analysis. Okay, for the timing, I'll just explain you some aspect of the vibration analysis, how we are concluding that what is the problem. I have already told you something during the boiler feed water pump case. Now this is such a vibration analysis. So these are the, you see, this is two proofs. The proximity proofs from the sensors, we are getting this signal. And these two proofs are combined in the X and Y axis to get a orbit plot. So these are called orbit plot in shaft vibration analysis. So this is also orbit plot. This orbit plot is the best when there is a simple circle. If this is a simple circle, I think I'll give you some example where this will be simple circle. Then the this is ideal condition. But here you see, this is not ideal condition. Some problem is going on here. The problem is that there is a lot of straight line variation. Okay, this is not a circle, complete circle. This is slightly circle, but still there is a problem here. There is some loops are there. This loops tells that there's some natural frequency occurring, some vibration, but still it is slightly circular, so it is somewhat better. But here you see the side, this is very, very straight line variation. This means what happened? This actually, the bearing here, it is being considered here, the bearing actually rubbing in the casing. So because of the rubbing, actually this actually give a strike to the shaft. The casing is giving, or journal is giving a strike to the shaft. So this particular vibration is happening. Very large straight line variation. This is slightly not better, but still better. This is also slightly better, but still these two cases are very, very severe cases of vibration. So I'll show you another type of analysis that we do in vibration. It is called spectrum plot. This time series that you take, this is a time series, this axis is time, and amplitude is the vibration in micron. So this time, when you do apply signal processing, like first Fourier transform. So if you apply first Fourier transform, you get spectrum. This spectrum are nothing but the x-axis is not time, it is frequency. This frequency is nothing but the speed, it is related to speed, the frequency of the vibration is related to the speed. So this is 1x means this is at the speed frequency. This is two harmonics, 2x. So 2 into speed. For example, this is 3000 RPM. So this will be 6000 RPM. This will be 9000 RPM. This is some 12000 RPM. So like that, these are the speed related cases. In this case, it can be assumed because all these harmonics are there and main 1x is there. We can tell there are some looseness. Means it is vibrating a lot and there's some looseness. In this case, there is a very subsynchronous vibration. Subsynchronous vibration means this is 1 into speed and this some fraction of the speed. So there is a subsynchronous vibration, which is very high, means there is some problem in the bearing that is happening. So with all these analysis, so we have analyzed completely in this case. This is another case of LP case. This is actually in NDE, it shows a normal vibration, but there is some reverse precision. This reverse precision means you see this amplitude and this amplitude, right hand side. So this is the middle spectrum, full spectrum. And then we can see left hand side vibration is very high than the right hand side. So that means this is a reverse precision. If at all this vibration will be higher, then it will be forward precision. So there is some problem, maybe in the proof or key feature, because of this is happening. And here you can see this is circle, means slightly better, but still the amount is very high, the gap is very high. So there is some problem here, but not much. This is for LP compressor, okay? Again, full spectrum we have considered. And here we can see number of 1x, 2x, 3x component, means there is some looseness or rubbing going on here, okay? Orbit plot is very irregular, but doesn't show rubbing. So rubbing is not there, but this is very irregular. So there is a lot of vibration going on. So this is the LP side spectrum in the steam turbine. You can see, as I've shown you this already, there are a lot of straight line variation. This shows that lobbing is very high here in this case. This also shows that there is some looseness. That means there is some friction already happened. So some material loss has happened, because of which this actually gives a very looseness of this journal and bearing. So this is all about the shaft vibration at the steam turbine. Now this is the shaft vibration. This is after signal processing, as I told you. After FFT analysis, we do half spectrum, and then we found this subsynchronous vibration. This is called subharmonic component or subsynchronous vibration. Okay, this component is very, very large. Okay, this, if at all this is amplitude is greater than 5 micron, then API 670 is telling that there is some problem here. The journal bearing has some problem. So that actually we have come across in this case. So this is the short vibration HP compressor. Already we have shown this spectrum, half spectrum, doing FFT analysis. Then this is the orbit analysis. There is straight line variation. We have already discussed this. So there is again some amount of rubbing. So the result of the vibration analysis is like this. The straight lines of unfiltered orbit plot is being seen. Okay, some harmonics of speeds has been seen in the spectrum. Then one subharmonics in spectrum, in particularly one slide, the two sides, that is steam turbine low pressure side and steam turbine high pressure side, we could see some sub synchronous vibration. So all these observations lead to region that rubbing at steam turbine is taking place. So this rubbing, because of that, we need to replace the shaft of the steam turbine, the rotor of the steam turbine. So this was our diagnostics. Though rubbing is mild, but still there is some rubbing is there, so we need to improve this. So now I'll show you the field observation. You can see here, this is the governor and in the steam turbine, you can see the rubbings, how these rubbings have happened, how there are marks in the steam turbine shaft rotor. There are this type of marks you can see here. These are the marks. These are the marks here. These marks here. So there are rubbing there. After our diagnostics, they actually arrange the rotor of this particular steam turbine. Then they replace the rotors. And then the timing of the case was very high. Then after that, they found some, these are the journal bearings. You know, you can see the rubbings here. Sorry. So you can see the rubbing marks here. These are the rubbing marks in the journal bearings. Okay, you can see here how the carbon has happened and the rubbings. So these are the different cases so that they could replace the case of the rotor, and then the maintenance time was saved. So our analysis result was that there was evidence of rubbing from the vibration analysis, either at bearing or seals or gear coupling. Some looseness has also been noted, some subsynchronous components, another 2x, 2 into RPM, 3 into RPM or speed components were found. Subsynchronous vibration with signs of rubbing may also be the effect of the either rubbing of the seal or bearing or excitation of natural frequency. So what happened? They replaced the shaft. They knew this prior to the maintenance, they knew the diagnostics. They arranged the shaft rotor or the rotor of the steam turbine and they replaced it. So we could save large maintenance time during the plant maintenance. So this is one of the advantage of this particular case study, that maintenance time was saved. So it is economically sustainable. So conclusion of my case study, I think I have taken only around 1 hour. So plant reliability analysis is the best means to have manufacturing sustainability by reducing the failures in machinery, diagnosing the exact failure to save the maintenance time. As you have seen, that this is the case for the fourth case study. And this is the case for all our case study. And reducing the leakages of materials from machines, thus reducing the maintenance cost and also production cost. So that the plant will be economically sustainable. Then different case studies were discussed, okay? So this actually explains how reliability is affected by the design of machinery. Design is very important part in the machinery selection. So we have to see the natural frequency. We have to see the weight of the system. We have to simulate how the vibration happens at different speed. We have seen different case study now. Then operation of the machinery. If the operation should not be around the torsional critical speeds or lateral critical speed. Operation should not be at a very large than the rated speed. So this type of cases, it will affect the reliability. And maintenance of the machinery. So the skills required for the maintenance, there should not be any error in the maintenance. Okay. And proper diagnosis of the failure. It will actually save a lot of maintenance time. So with this, I end my talk on this sustainable manufacturing using by improving the reliability of the plants. So again, thanks to the organizers for the invitation, and all of you, the participants, delegates, thank you for your patience. You can very well contact me whenever you want in this mail ID as well as my LinkedIn profile. You can contact me, and thank you very much for this opportunity to speak on my experiences in the field maintenance or reliability. Thank you very much. Any question? Because I have given actually a lot of time for question and answer session. So
yes, sir. Yeah. Sir, Dilip sir. Sir, we have two questions from Ajay Singh Jamwal, sir. That will occasionally late case like a seismic can be also be analyzed in case of pump vibration.
Yes, yes. What happens? I told you that velocity. There are three ways we calculate the vibration or we measure the vibration. One is the sharp vibration, which is in micron. I told you the micron is one aspect. Another is the velocity, that is meter per second. Another is acceleration, that is meter per second square. This seismic vibration is generally being considered as meter per second or velocity. So the sensor that is being used, also known as seismometer, that means seismometer is required to measure the velocity of the vibration of the pump, and that also reflects the vibration of the foundation or the foundation of the complete plant. So in that sense, this same case, we can find out that is there any seismic vibration or not, the foundation vibration we can find out using this seismometer or velocity of the vibration.
Sir, another question is there. But duplex stainless steel is so costly and mainly used for offshore application. If we design the blades of duplex stainless steel, cost it will be increased or decreased?
No. First of all, the U-bolt is very small size, not the blade. Blades are of 1.5 or 2 meter length. Mm-hmm. Well, these blades are made of Atlac resin. They're not from any material. They're from Atlac resin material, not from any duplex steel or nothing. It is simple. So the weight is around, I can tell you, weight is around 25 kg or 30 kg. Okay. So that weight is not much, but the duplex is for the U-bolt. U-bolt were actually made of steel earlier. So when we made of duplex, the corrosion was not taking place. It was corrosion free. So the cost was definitely higher. The cost, for example, one U-bolt, cost were around $200. But when we made it duplex, it become $3,000. The cost was higher, but the fact is that the improvement in efficiency that we got, the failure that we completely eliminated. For example, in 3 years, earlier, there were some 150 failures. In 3 years after this, we have hardly 2 to 3 failures. So because of that, the improvement in efficiency that we observed, improvement in maintenance cost, that is very high than the cost of the steel, duplex steel. So hardly that cost difference is $1,000, but still the improvement that we found is much more. It is of $1 million. So you can compare $1 million and $1,000.
Yes, sir. Sir, another question is from YouTube Live. You mentioned that you are green belt in the Six Sigma, in Honeywell. So, yes. So how to get certificate in Six Sigma in Honeywell? So like that.
No, Honeywell. I was working in Honeywell, so that's the reason there was a mandate to do Six Sigma certification because I was working at Honeywell. So Honeywell gave me that certification. Even when I was working at GE, I had trained Six Sigma, but I didn't get the certification because I changed the job to Honeywell. But even through certification, there are a lot of private certification is available. The only thing, the project that you do should be somewhat valuable to the industry. If your project selection is very high, very good, then you can get a very good Six Sigma experiences. For example, I have got Honeywell, I have done 2 Six Sigma project in Honeywell, which is industry specific. Then I did 2 Six Sigma project, which I have not discussed here, in Sabic also. So those are very high quality in nature. When you do Six Sigma, even if at all opportunity comes, I can explain you what is Six Sigma and how this apply to different cases. But if you apply this, that is, your research time becomes very less. Because as I, Professor Bhargav has explained, that initially you go to the people. So in Six Sigma, there is a process called voice of customer. So we visit to different customer sites. We want to know their problem. And after knowing their problem, we'll give solution. So this is inside Six Sigma itself. This is a technique called voice of customer. So in that sense, whatever research outcome that you give, that is actually useful to the industry. That actually, whatever product you will make, that will be very useful. In my case, in Honeywell, I have done 2 products. And these products are now being sold to different plants. So these products, one is called Asset Manager or Asset Sentinel. So this is made out of the Six Sigma process. We have undergone Six Sigma process. So our research time was very less, but our usefulness is very high because we went to different customer sites. Almost all good industry I visited during my project. I have gone to Reliance, HPCL, ONGC. So some big companies I have gone through, Nalco, and I have taken their opinion, their data. I have found out what are the different way to mitigate their pain point. And then this software was developed. And now they're selling this software to different customers. So as I told you, there are different processes inside the Six Sigma. One is voice of customer, as Professor Bhargav explained very nicely, that you have to go to the customer and know their pain point. Why this problem is required? As you see my case studies, there are some pain points from the customers. Customers were telling that in very large maintenance cost, very large reliability issues. How to solve that? So this is one way of doing Six Sigma research, telling that if at all our analysis, if at all we'll do this way, then we'll improve the reliability and then we'll improve the reliability and sustainability of the plant. So Six Sigma is a process. We can do certification anywhere privately, but the project that you do, please do that. As Professor Bhargav has explained very nicely, go to the people for whom you are doing this project. And then apply it. It may be industrial problem, it may be agricultural problem, anywhere you can apply that.
Sir, another question is there from YouTube. What are the recent software for data analytics which are used in industries?
You see, in industry, generally Meridium is a software, and there are Meridium is conducting lot of private training that you can register very well. For example, one is RCM training. I'm an advanced RCM certified from Meridium. Meridium is one analysis where you can provide different algorithm and find out your data. This is one Meridium software is there. I generally do in Honeywell, I was doing MATLAB. I was implementing MATLAB. MATLAB is actually a lot of different toolboxes are there. Toolboxes related to signal processing, toolboxes related to artificial intelligence, toolboxes related to statistics. So different toolboxes are there. Your algorithm time will be very less because already those built-in algorithms are there. You don't need to do your own algorithm. Like in C, C++, you don't need to design the algorithm. Already there are built-in algorithms are there. You can reuse that and then apply your data analytics. So this is very important. For example, in my case, all these FFT analysis, even I have invented a new signal processing algorithm called short time, MFT, that is multi-resolution Fourier transform. So corrected multi-resolution Fourier transform. So that I have used using MATLAB only I have done this. So different type of algorithm you can do and the efforts will be very less. There are also nowadays R is available. Okay, so that also is another free software available. But MATLAB, I think, is a paid software. If at all you are in organization, you can order that.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions?
Thank you, sir. There's information for the participants also. that Professor Parag Bhargava sir is still online to address some queries of the participant. You can ask Parag Bhargava sir and also ask to Dr. Chinmayakar sir. Please, any questions?
Actually, I got a question before, just before my case, that is Industry 4.0. Okay, let me tell one just point on that. That, as you know, as I told you, this reliability or condition monitoring algorithms, it, actually this Industry 4.0 is nothing but it is a automation of these algorithms. And once you do this automation, then you don't need experts like us, because our experts knowledge has already been incorporated there. We can be only there for monitoring and control, not for the doing day-to-day affairs. So Industry 4.0, that's the reason, is very important, that all automation, all optimization, the optimization control, everything can be done using one particular software or hardware. So that's the reason Industry 4.0 is now the most important, you can tell, innovation in this line, reliability or condition monitoring line.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Sir, I have one question. Myself is Ajay Singh, sir. I have one question that you have given a lecture on the balancing of a pumps. My question is that during the balancing, whether you will balance the pump without piping or after attaching the piping system, like some pipe will be connected there, then you will take care all the vibration of that, or just for the equipment, sir? Just mera question. Can I ask in Hindi, sir? You can understand Hindi.
No. Okay. Yeah, I can understand your question. I understood your question. The first of all, you see, when the balancing is done, okay, the complete system, actually it is a rotor balancing. The shaft vibrates, okay. The shaft vibrates and the casing, all these has a natural frequency. So we know that what is the natural frequency, we can measure that. And then the shaft vibrates and this shaft should not vibrate a lot. So its speed should be less than or very high than, higher than the natural frequency. So we actually balance the shaft, not the casing or the pipe. Now the your question is very good, that what happens if at all the pipes and all other systems are there? Yes, because of the pipes, let us consider there's a pipe looseness somewhere. Then the natural frequency changes. So what we need to do, we actually find the how the natural frequency changes with time. Okay, so that actually is independent of the balancing. The natural frequency is independent of the balancing. Only thing, the speed should not be equal to the natural frequency. But the balancing is done for the movable part. That is the blades, there'll be some correction weight will be given to the blades. We'll give some correction weight on the shaft. Okay, so this is the difference actually. So,
sir, actually, in reciprocating pumps, basically when pipe system is connected to it, we are providing the adjustable supports at the first starting at the inlet of the pump, and then pulsating frequency, some mechanism is there, I don't know the exact name, pulsating frequency will be carried out by the vendor, vibration analyzer. That's why I'm saying, asking that question, ki whether you are saying we are balancing only the rotary part, that is mainly inside the pump, that is the shaft and all the rotary parts.
Yeah.
The pipe. So,
So whatever you told, you correct, that the in the case of finding out the natural frequency, we provide a pulse, okay? And that pulse will return back what is the particular frequency that we get. That is a free vibration analysis or even forced vibration analysis we do for the casing.
Okay.
To get the natural frequency of the system.
Okay.
Okay. Now the balancing can be done independent of this casing also. The, for example, the initially when they do balancing, they do in the manufacturing, not manufacturing, the industry which is the original equipment manufacturer. But when they come to the plant, they do another balancing because there all the pipes are connected.
Sir, you are taking the cases for the seismic load also, occasional load also, or you will take only the operating and sustained cases? Like, maniki, operating you are taking it, or you are taking considering the case of occasional like seismic or something?
Seismic like is that. Generally in the design stage, they consider the seismic vibration, what is the complex vibration system. What we do in the field, we actually find this particular natural frequency, how it varies, and the speed should not be equal to them. Understand me? So
system shall also be carried out, because by the way, some unnatural thing will occur, then the our task is to safeguard the pump. Then I think that the seismic load can also be taken care.
Yes, so all the load, for example, at that particular point of time, the operating, when the design happened in the manufacturing side, design of the pump, okay, they have considered all these aspects and they have tested in their bed, and then they have sent the pump to us. So they have tested in their side that these are the different things that this particular pump can withstand. These are the vibration. Then when they bring to us, our side, okay, without connecting to the any machinery, they do vibration analysis. Then they connect all these and then they do the vibration analysis. They do this ramp-up test. Ramp-up test means gradually the speed is increasing and they measure vibration. Okay, vibration. They do this free vibration, telling what is the casing natural frequency. Okay, so the balancing, what you told are the first question, the balancing can be done online as well as offline. Some of the cases they have done balancing online also. Okay. Offline also that can be done by completely separating out, they can do. But online vibration, online balancing also is being done to the movie view part.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Any questions from the participant to any of the speaker? So I think there will be no questions. So we are in the closing session of the webinar. So we are coming to end of the webinar. So I request our HOD Dr. Mrutyunjay Rao sir to share something about this webinar, end of this webinar. Thank you. Mrutyunjay sir.
Thank you, Ajit. I am audible?
Yes.
Okay. I think the seminar, the webinar comes to an end, and I hope all the participants have enriched with the knowledge provided by our eminent speakers, Dr. Parag and Bhargav and Dr. Chinmayakar. So I want to tell that the presentation of Dr. Chinmayakar was very nice, and he has explained regarding the vibration of shafts and bearings. That is very useful. And recently, in this current semester, the students are going to enroll in mechanical vibration. That is very interesting, and that will also help them, our students and also the faculty members, those who have interest in that line. And regarding the presentation of Dr. Bhargav, and it is a very nice presentation regarding that interesting thing that the mask that he has they are developing, and he has explained regarding the protection. So I really congratulate our team, and I am very much thankful to the speakers and all the participants for having their patience to listen, and our faculty members, team members, those who are worked dedicatedly throughout last 7 days hard, so that the webinar will be successful. And I am sure that it was successful, and it is meaningful for all the attendees. So thank you, everybody. Thank you. It is over to Ajit Patel.
I thank our Professor Parag Bhargav sir. Actually, we have met before at IIT Bombay when I was Dr. LP Ponda sir was attended the end-to-end innovation, and there we met Professor Bhargav sir, and there we have seen the presentations and their labs, and from there we have decided to call him to our college for the seminar or for the workshop, but unfortunately due to COVID the physical presence was not possible, but with this webinar I think Professor Bhargav has shared a lot to the participant. And for the another speaker, Dr. Chinmayakar sir, I thanks to our colleague Dr. L.P. Ponda sir to give the link to Chinmayakar sir for the invitation. And we have seen the very nice presentation from him also. And I thank to our Department of Mechanical Engineering. Thanks to all the HODs, all the advisory team members, all the organizing team members, our principal sir, our TechCube coordinator for supporting in every step of this webinar. Thank you. Thank you all.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
I just wanted to say thanks for the opportunity. I really enjoyed participating in the webinar, and hopefully maybe get to visit your college sometime.
Thank you.
Definitely, sir, we will welcome you to our college.
Yeah. Thanks, and bye.
Bye, sir. So we'll come to an end.
All the participants can fill out the feedback form.
Feedback form is not
The feedback form is in the chat box.
Not working properly.
Not working. Okay. We'll send it to the mail. If it will not work, we'll send it to the mail.
Please include the name also, sir. For printing of certificate, name is required.
Okay. We'll do that. Okay, we'll definitely do that. Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, Bharava.
Okay, thank you very much.
Our invitation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bharava.
Thank you for inviting. Bye.
Bye. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Yes, sir. We'll leave. Thank you all.